welcome everybody to one of the greatest venues in all of American sports, Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska. It is an unseasonably warm and windy day in this great capital city as the Penn State Nittany Lions are in town to take on the 16th-ranked Cornhuskers, who are getting ready to take the field before an NCAA record 324th consecutive sellout crowd, nearly 85,000 here. It's a sellout streak that dates back 50 years to 1962. This crowd is fired up. Nebraska, winners of three straight, in control of its own destiny in the Legends Division of the Big Ten. The Huskers tied with Michigan atop the Legends Division, but the Cornhuskers have the tiebreaker, the head-to-head win over the Wolverines here. Michigan's in overtime right now with Northwestern. Penn State still holding out hopes of a Leaders Division title in the Big Ten. Ohio State would clinch at least a tie with a Nebraska victory here today. Hello, everybody, and welcome. Sean McDonough along with Chris Spielman, joined in a moment by Quint Kesenick. Delighted to have you with us. Nebraska has had the knack for coming from behind to win this year. They've had three wins coming from double digits down, including last week at Michigan State. More heroics from the terrific dual-threat quarterback, Taylor Martinez.
Yeah, he was absolutely terrific last week, especially with his feet, going for 205 yards. Defensive coordinator Ted Roof talked about what they had to do as a unit to stop them, and you have to get a man in a half on them. What I mean by getting a man and a half, obviously you're going to have one of your defensive ends or defensive lines account for them. But here's where Michigan State did not get a man and a half. Watch this. There's nobody on Taylor Martinez, no secondary support, and when he sees a hole, he's got a great burst and he knows how to finish. Now, Penn State did a good job against Braxton Miller. They have a man spying Braxton Miller. Then they also have Mike Motti, number 42, the linebacker, coming up and making sure they have a man and a half right there. That's how you control the zone read option against Nebraska.
It's been a remarkable season for Penn State. After losing their first two this year, the Nittany Lions have won six of their last seven. And as a senior, Matt McGloin has emerged as one of the fine quarterbacks in this league.
Sean, 18 touchdowns against three interceptions. And you think about it, Bill O'Brien was able to put this complex offense that he brought from New England in with this. He's a smart guy. He makes good decisions, and he's very accurate with the football. He needs to be accurate against a very tough pass defense that the Cornhuskers bring.
Two of the great programs in the history of college football going head-to-head here in Lincoln. Penn State and Nebraska in the kickoff after this. Back in Lincoln, Nebraska, we mentioned at the outset, unseasonably warm day. The average high here is in the low to mid 50s this time of the year. It is 77 degrees with the wind howling out of the south. Gusts up to 34 miles per hour. There is the chance of some thunderstorms here later today. Nebraska won the toss and deferred. So Penn State will receive the opening kickoff. Brett Maher, the former walk-on, down to Jesse Della Valle from the goal line. Breaks some tackles and a good return to the 26. Justin Blatchard made the tackle. Here's Quint Kesenick.
Some good news in the injury department for Penn State there. Difference-making defensive tackle Jordan Hill is actually dressed. Limited participation this week in practice. All he did was ride the bike on the sideline, but he's got the knee brace on his left knee. He looks ready to go. Offensively, Kyle Carter is also in the lineup. Redshirt freshman, tight end, second leading receiver on the team. He's got his left ankle tightly wrapped.
Carter did not make the trip to Purdue last week. Matt McGloin handed it off to Zach Zwinak. Tried to turn the corner. Got a hard-earned yard. Tackled by Ciante Evans. Matt McGloin, one of the most improved quarterbacks in the country this year. Senior from Scranton, Pennsylvania. 2,436 passing yards and 18 touchdown passes, tied with Taylor Martinez of Nebraska for the conference lead. 2,436 yards already, the sixth highest single season total in Penn State history. Zwinak straight ahead and stopped behind the line of scrimmage. Baker Steinkuhler, the senior from Lincoln, Nebraska.
Tried to do, Sean, is spread him out. Anytime you want to spread out, oftentimes you set up the trap. Nebraska was prepared for it, and the skilled people from Penn State came up to the line of scrimmage late, trying to confuse Nebraska with getting in their alignment late.
Penn State's been a tremendous first quarter team. That scored the opposition 76-3. McGloin on third and 11. Got it off. Wide open receiver. Brandon Mosby Felder. Out of bounds at midfield. Forced out by Damian Stafford. 23 yards on third down and 11.
Now, Bill O'Brien talks about pocket presence with Matt McGloin. Right there, there's no panic. Allowing his receivers to run the rub route, to come across, buying time, and making an accurate throw with a Cornhusker hanging on his leg.
Zwinak threw a big haul. Zwinak! His longest run of the season's going to end in the end zone. Touchdown, 50 yards. And Chris, we talked to Bo Pelini yesterday about Penn State's ability to dominate the first quarter. Asked him, if you win the toss, might you receive the opening kickoff? Try to keep the Penn State offense off the field. He said, I just don't like to do that. I thought about it, but I just don't like to do that. You wonder if he regrets not doing it now.
I'm sure he does. He likes to have the extra possession in the second half, but what a start by Penn State.
Low snap, but it was handled. Ty Howell snap. Ryan Kaiser got it down, and Sam Ficken kicked the extra point. Zwinak's their leading rusher for the year, but his longest run this season had been just 18 yards. That's only their third run of the year that went for longer than 20 yards.
Let's take a look at Baker Steinkuhler, number 55, who made the play earlier on the same play. Now watch what happens. He's going to overrun it a little bit, gets pushed through the gap. You get a good block on Compton, the center. Zwinak gets to the second level with nobody touching him. That's outstanding on the offensive line, sustaining blocks. And you see the big fella rumbling, coming off that career high of 134 last week, adding to that total.
Here are the numbers in the first quarter of the season for Penn State. On average, during the first quarters this season, they've held the ball for almost 10 minutes. And they've outscored their opponents in the first quarter by 8 points per game. They've given up just 3 points all year in the first quarter, a field goal at Purdue last week. And more of the same for both of these teams. A quick lead for Penn State, and Nebraska once again forced to play from behind. Sam Ficken kicking into that gusty wind. Bounces one down the field. Scooped up by Kenny Bell. And he danced out to the 34-yard line. That wind, probably another reason why Bo Pelini decided to go on defense first, let Penn State play into the wind. It did not stop the Nittany Lions as they went 74 yards in four plays. Here come the Huskers. Best offensive team in the Big Ten this year, led by the junior from Corona, California, Taylor Martinez. Hands it off to Amir Abdullah. And he's banged out of bounds by the middle linebacker, Glenn Carson. Both Abdullah and Taylor Martinez ran for 100-plus last week at Michigan State. In that game, Martinez became the all-time leader in total offense at the University of Nebraska. Passed the great Heisman Trophy winner, Eric Crouch, because Taylor's got a long way to go. Still in his junior year.
Throws to the near side, caught by Quincy Enunwa, who broke a tackle, but that turns out to be not such a great thing as he lost yardage. Taken down by Gerald Hodges. Glenn Carson also there.
Thing about Taylor Martinez, Sean, he's really improved his accuracy, and that's come from working on his footwork in the offseason and not the shoulder tilt or the javelin type release that he had last year. Much better mechanically.
63% completions, that's up 7% from last year. Movement, Mike Motti came across the line of scrimmage.
Offense number 80.
And it was drawn across.
Still third down.
By Kenny Bell.
And Mike Motti didn't even see Kenny Bell. His eyes, he went on the hard count. Kenny Bell just also went on the hard count. So, gotta be disciplined, especially if you're the home team.
Third down and 13 now for Nebraska. Martinez. Dangerous runner. By some room with the pump fake and runs out of bounds. Very near the first down marker. They're going to give him the 45 and a first down with a 12-yard gain.
Well, this is what he's doing all year, and this will drive a defensive coordinator crazy. You have outstanding coverage down the field. You lose outside contain. But anytime you got a threat running the football in the quarterback position, there's really nothing you can do to that but put a spy on him.
High formation now for Nebraska. Quick toss to Abdullah. Powerfully built at just 185 pounds. Drag tacklers for an 8-yard gain. Impact players brought to you by Chick-fil-A.
And so Abdullah right there getting an opportunity, making the most of it without Burkhead. Also Kenny Bell, their best wide receiver, Eric Martin, will be a force in the pass rush.
Abdullah again, big hole. He got banged down by Stephon Morris after Malcolm Willis had him around the legs. Morris hit him high. 7-yard gain. Another first down for Nebraska. The Penn State 40.
And the Nittany Lion defense and Ted Roof were a little bit concerned about the tempo. Two tosses in a row. Can we make it three or a little play action off the toss?
See the diversity of this Nebraska offense. They can play spread football. They can play power running football. Martinez incomplete in the direction of Jake Long. Sean Stanley applied some pressure on Taylor Martinez.
Well, you almost felt that coming, a little fake toss in the bootleg. I think you keep running that toss until Penn State stops it. It's not a bad idea, but good discipline right there by Sean Stanley, number 90, holding contain, not letting Martinez get outside.
Abdullah has blockers. Amir Abdullah down at the 32-yard line in the arms of Gerald Hodges. 8-yard gain for Abdullah. He went for 110 last week in their come-from-behind win at East Lansing.
One of the things Nebraska does a really good job of doing is their wide receivers get downfield and make blocks. Very aggressive. Another thing that the concerned Ted Roof, and that's something they take pride in as a unit.
Also without Rex Burkhead again today, one of the all-time leading rushers in Nebraska football history, sixth all-time, more than 3,000 career yards, but he's been bothered by a sprained knee. Raylan Hurd came in at tailback, tried to block for Martinez, and Taylor has a first down to the 29-yard line, pulled across the boundary by Stephen Obing-Ajapon.
A nice job by C.J. Zimmer, number 31, out in the flat, does not become a receiver. Recognize Taylor tucks it. He turns and becomes a blocker right away.
Nebraska, terrific first down team, averaging 7.3 per first down for the season. 52% of their total yards for the year come on first down. Martinez in trouble on this first down and yanked down back at the 38-yard line by Deion Barnes, the redshirt freshman from Philadelphia, with his team-leading fifth sack of the year.
Watch Deion Barnes on a get-off. Everything is about get-off right there. Does not go for any fakes. And you have Troy, number 77, miss his block and throw a no-hitter, and Deion Barnes is able to hold on and finish.
Ted Roos, the defensive coordinator, came to Penn State after 3 years at Auburn, a part of their national championship team 2 years ago. Loss of 8, second and 18. Martinez sets up a screen for Abdullah. Again, blockers in front. Abdullah stopped by Malcolm Willis. Monty trying to rip it out. Then he got decked late in a flag thrown on Jeremiah Searles. The right tackle for Nebraska leveled Mike Motti, apparently after the whistle. John O'Neill is the referee leading this Big Ten crew.
After the play was over, dead ball, personal foul, 71 offense, 15 yards from the end of the run, third down.
Starts to being about discipline right here. First of all, they have a good play. They have 3-on-2, and I got to tell you, Malcolm Willis made a heck of a play defeating a blocker. Then you have an undisciplined play by Searles, who we had a chance to talk to yesterday. Didn't seem like he would do that kind of play, but he did.
Struck us as kind of a gentle giant. We visited with Jeremiah yesterday, junior from Lakewood, Colorado, the suburbs of Denver. 15-yard gain, but then the 15-yard penalty brings it back. Martinez has his receiver. Jamal Turner banged out at the 6 by Adrian Amos. Beautiful throw by Martinez. First and goal, Nebraska.
What a difference a year makes. Taylor Martinez keeping his eyes down the field. Not making the easy throw, but trusting his arm to throw back across his bar to Jamal Turner coming on a skinny post. And Jamal was able to finish, catch the ball in stride.
Penn State scored in its first possession. Nebraska trying to answer and tie the game. Abdullah smothered by Sean Stanley. They're going to mark it back at the 12-yard line.
That's on Taylor Martinez, Sean. They're letting Sean Stanley run up the field in a zone read option. His eyes have to go to the defensive end. That was a poor read, which resulted in a TFL tackle for loss for Sean Stanley.
His seventh of the year. He's a senior from Rockville, Maryland. Midway through the first quarter.
One-on-one coverage down here at the bottom of your screen against the best receiver, Kenny Bell.
Penn State's the best red zone defensive team in the Big Ten. And living up to it again, Abdullah dropped for a loss of about three more. Deion Barnes, the fabulous freshman. They're going to mark it at the 14, a loss of two. And Nebraska's going in reverse.
Amir Abdullah likes the outside. He's a good insider, but his comfort level is the outside. And you have defensive ends upfield like that. They're taking off any angle he has to get to the outside.
14th play of this opening drive for Nebraska. Penn State opponents have scored only 63% of the time in the red zone this year. That's seventh best in the nation. In red zone defense, trying to do it again. Martinez. Running out of time. And runs out of bounds for a loss of another yard. That's three straight negative yardage plays for Nebraska after they had first and goal. Stephon Morris chased Martinez out, and here's Brett Maher trying to kick a field goal. He missed his only try last week at Michigan State, a chip shot 30-yarder. This will be 32 from the left hash mark with that howling wind at his back. J. Mangieri, fourth year as the snapper. Jace Dean, the holder. And that is right down the middle for the senior from Kearney, Nebraska, Brett Maher. Well, each team has scored on its first possession, and Penn State leads Nebraska 7-3. Long ABC and ESPN saluting our veterans in a moving ceremony here at Memorial Stadium in Lincoln before the game today. Ed Guthrie, 94 years old, honored for his distinguished service to our country, the Pearl Harbor survivor. May God continue to bless him and all the men and women who serve and have served our country with such distinction.
Greatest generation.
Maher will kick off. Penn State defense rose up in the red zone on that 15-play drive engineered by Nebraska. The Penn State defense had 5 tackles for a loss. They averaged 6.6 tackles per loss per game. They had 5 on that opening drive.
When Nebraska gets the ball back, look for them to attack inside because of the outside defenders of the defensive ends for the Nittany Lions are penetrating up the field, cutting any outside runs off.
Maher, you'd expect a lot of touchbacks in this direction by both teams today with that gusty breeze. He booted it to the back of the end zone. Here's Robert Flores with an update.
All right, Sean, here's what's happening on SportsCenter right now, brought to you by HP Michigan, which needs a Nebraska loss and then a win against Ohio State to get into the Big Ten Championship. They beat number 24 Northwestern 38-31. And in the Florida-Louisiana Lafayette game, the Gators win on a walk-off blocked punt return for touchdown. Delaney Jenkins takes it in at the Swamp.
Wow. Dramatic win for Michigan. They had to rally in the final seconds of regulation to force that overtime in the season full of blown leads for Northwestern. Zwinak on first down. Zach got 3. We look at the impact players for Penn State, brought to you by Chick-fil-A.
Yeah, you start with Zwinak, who's already made his impact known. Allen Robinson, deep threat for the Nittany Lions. And Jordan Hill, the best defensive tackle that I've seen on film this year.
Robinson's the leading receiver in the Big Ten. That number's unusual for Penn State. As we showed you earlier, usually dominate time of possession in the first quarter, but they were a quick strike team on their opening drive. Matt McGloin with all day to throw. Steps into one and has his man. The tight end, Matt Lehman, with his 17th catch of the year. Good for 16 yards and a first down.
Well, it starts up front, and what an outstanding job from the 5 big hogs for Penn State Nittany Lions, giving Matt McGloin time and allowing the receivers to work. And when he has that kind of time, he's accurate with the football, and he always makes the right decision.
An offensive line from left to right, Donovan Smith, Miles Diven back, Matt Stankavich, John Urschel, and Mike Farrell, providing great protection for McGloin. With 5 minutes to go in the opening quarter, Zwinak smothered behind that awful offensive line. Talk so much about. How about Urschel, the right guard? 4.0 grade point average. He graduated in 3 years with a degree in mathematics, now working on a master's in mathematics. Recently named one of Penn State's 4 players on the all-district, all-academic team. Makes him a candidate for academic All-American. Penn State and Nebraska both had 4 all-district academic selections, tying them for the most in the country with Duke and Northern Illinois. A blitz. McGloin on 2nd and 10 has a receiver across midfield. Allen Robinson with his 58th catch of the year. Now 5 away from tying the Penn State single season record.
Hey, Sean, one of the matchups that I was looking forward to today, not just with players, but I'm talking about the matchup between Bill O'Brien, basically the offensive coordinator for the Penn State Nittany Lions, and of course right there, Bo Pelini, who has his hand in every defense called. 2 great young coaches, very bright. And they're doing battle themselves. I love it.
Fiery competitors. Each admits he has a bit of a temper. O'Brien's 43 and Pelini 44. 3rd down and 3. McGloin flushed. Crowd wanted a holding penalty. It looked like Anchor was being held. And Mosby Felder dropped the ball. And there is a flag down in the backfield. Clear case of holding as McGloin rolled out. Jason Anchor was being held by Mike Farrell, the right tackle, himself a 4.0 student the last spring semester.
Holding. Offense, number 78. 10 yards from the previous spot. Repeat, 3rd down.
You might ask why you want to repeat that 3rd down. Bill O'Brien's known to go for it on 4th down right around midfield. I guarantee he probably would have went for it. But the matchup I was talking about between Bo Pelini and Bill O'Brien, Penn State likes to use a lot of those rub routes or bunch routes. Nebraska won that battle. They weren't fooled, and they covered everybody downfield, which caused a holding and McGloin scrambling.
Both of these head coaches have experience in the NFL as assistant coaches. A lot of professional football concepts to what they do. Third down and 14. Another Nebraska blitz. McGloin throws off his back foot. It's caught by Allen Robinson. Inbounds at the 29-yard line of Nebraska. Never what a throw by McGloin, Matt. Chris, into this win. Matt McGloin, the great throw.
Never look until the receiver looks. Stanley Jean Baptiste looks back too early before the hands go back. See, watch him look back. Then once he looked back, Sean, Robinson was able to pull away, stay inbounds, and make a great catch. And you're right, into that win, that ball was put right where it needed to be. And Bo's saying, don't look back until the hands go up.
30-yard gain. Penn State, no trouble now. Two possessions in a row to start the game, driving into this 35-mile-an-hour win. Swinnack, early in the year, was running back by committee, largely due to injuries, but the last couple of weeks, Swinnack has established himself as their primary ball carrier. He had his first career start last week at Purdue and rushed for a career high 134.
One thing I love about this, Coach Bill O'Brien is putting competition in practice. You practice the best in the week, you're going to play. And that's what happens. Swinnack practiced better than Bill Belton. He took advantage of that opportunity by going for 134 and is off to a last week and off to a quick start this week.
Belton did not have a carry last week in their easy win at Purdue. Play clock running down. Got it off with 1 second. McGloin just did get it off. It's incomplete. Intended for Allen Robinson. The defensive coaches, John Papuchis, the defensive coordinator, told us yesterday, they know, obviously, everybody knows, Penn State like to throw quickly. They're going to blitz a lot today and try to throw off that quick passing game.
Oh, especially against Penn State, because last week Purdue brought a lot of zone pressures that caused Matt McGloin and Penn State a few problems early on.
John Papuchis, a rising star in college coaching, hoping for a big play. Run his defense on third down and 7. Four-man rush and a receiver wide open over the middle. Kyle Carter, the freshman tight end, moves the chains to the 13-yard line. A completion of 12.
Starts with alignment and assignment. Right now, Nebraska's confused. They don't know who has who. Matt McGloin again with the crossing routes. I promise you this, Sean. One underneath, one is behind. Kyle Carter does a good job of sitting right down there in the zone, finding the open area, and securing the catch.
McGloin's 5 out of 6. Here in the first quarter, going into this win. Swinnack lost the football, and Nebraska got it back. Will Compton recovered it. Alonzo Whaley knocked it out.
Good things happen when you wrap your arms. Watch Alonzo Whaley come in here. Right there, he wraps his arms, the ball pops up, and Will Compton's there for the recovery.
Sean Fisher started to pull it out, helped loosen it up, then Whaley delivered the hit, and Compton recovered. Penn State's best this year in the Big Ten in turnover margin. Nebraska's the worst, but they have the first takeaway to the Huskers today. Yesterday was a training day here at the University of Nebraska for its Air Force, Army, and Marine Corps ROTC programs. Today, a very special day for Marine Corps Master Sergeant Adam Criswell, honored for his 20 years of service. He brought the coin out onto the field for the pregame flip. Today, the 237th birthday of the Marine Corps. Amir Abdullah breaks a couple of tackles. Lots of room up the far sideline and shoved out by Jacob Pagnano at the 39. Gain of 33 and a first down for Nebraska.
Yeah, it's all about staying on your blocks right there. Searles gets his block. See him hook the defensive end right there. And Quincy Anunwa doing his job, like we talk about, wide receivers blocking downfield. Now, if Bell would have came back, maybe that's 6. But outstanding sustaining of blocks by the Cornhusker O-line.
Back to power football. Braylon Hurd jumps over would-be tacklers. Sophomore from Youngstown, Ohio. Tackled by Deion Barnes. A gain of 7.
As we talked about, they're hitting it up inside now because of the penetration of the defensive ends for Penn State outside.
Following the fullback, C.J. Zimmerer hurt again. And he's down to the 39-yard line. Pagnano, another stop for the Lions. 15 yards and another first down for the Cornhuskers.
And right here, you're going to see again another receiver block by Nunwa. Look at him staying inside, inside, and finishing. That's what they do. That's what they preach. That's what they execute.
Less than a minute to go. Isn't broken. Don't fix it. They stay with Hurd. Another power run to the 36. Glenn Carson, the junior middle linebacker, with the stop for the Penn State defense.
It's funny, we're always used to seeing those spread offenses. They're going old school, Tom Osborne, I-back formation. Let the I-back do the work.
Andy Janovich, a walk-on, true freshman, now in at fullback. Julia didn't follow him and got tripped up. Penn State was not fooled by the fullback heading one way and Abdullah going the other. Barnes, another stop. He's had a terrific first quarter that has come to an end. In warm and windy Lincoln, Nebraska, Penn State leading 7-3. Memorial Stadium, Lincoln, Nebraska. 7-3, Penn State with the lead after one quarter. It's third down and 10 for the Huskers at the Penn State 39. Nittany Lions blitz. Taylor Martinez trying to turn the corner, get away from Deion Barnes. He did, and he lowers his shoulder to get the first down. Was not afraid of the oncoming linebacker, Gerald Hodges. And Taylor Martinez has done it with his legs again, 12 yards.
Jordan Hill doesn't look limited there, beating his man one-on-one. But once again, Taylor Martinez, the danger he can do with his feet. Barnes loses contain, Martinez makes him pay.
He's taken some shots this year as Martinez, Abdullah breaking tackles and spins for nine. To the 18-yard line, Malcolm Willis, the safety, had to make another stop.
Amir Abdullah, Sean, I mean, losing Burkhead's a big deal. But I'll tell you, it's to get him 20 carries a game, that's a plus for Nebraska, in my opinion.
That's on his way to his fourth straight 100-yard rushing game. Ordinarily, that would be Burkhead in short yardage and goal line. A flag down. They might have pulled him down by the face mask. He got the first down just shy of the 15-yard line.
And we're seeing that toss play. It's not outside. It's an inside run.
Personal foul. Face mask. Defense. Number 27. Half the distance from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
And they announced it on number 27, Jake Fagnano. But it looked like it was Sean Stanley who was number 90.
Nothing malicious about that. Sometimes you got a big guy hanging on, you're sticking that arm out there trying to get a play, and sometimes you do get the mask.
First and goal, Nebraska, trying to take its first lead of the game. Penn State defense stiffened on the first penetration into the end zone by Taylor Martinez and the Huskers, forced a field goal. Abdullah ran into the pile. Malcolm Willis up.
And this is a great job by Ted Roof right here. They had a blitz to the field. They saw Nebraska check and out-oblige. You know what Penn State did? They checked and out-oblige their blitz to the short side of the field, which Abdullah ran right into. Outstanding coaching and good job by Mike Motti making the audible on the field.
Second and goal. A fake reverse, and again, the Nittany Lions are not fooled. Abdullah wrestled down by Sean Stanley. Ted Roof talked to us the other day about what a nice game Stanley had last week at Purdue, and he's off to a good start again today. That's the seventh tackle for a loss already for the Penn State defense.
As a defensive end, you've got to keep contained and get upfield. That's what Penn State's committed to do. That's why Nebraska's had some success running inside, not outside.
Three wide receivers on third down and goal. From the 10-yard line. Martinez sings one incomplete. Going into the end zone to Kyler Reed, the tight end, who was well covered by Gerald Hodges, Malcolm Willis.
It's a high-low coverage. You have Hodges underneath, Malcolm Willis over the top. The ball's thrown where it needs to be thrown. But Gerald Hodges, who could run for a linebacker, doing a pretty good job of man-to-man coverage in a two-deep look with safety help, playing that underneath coverage, disrupting the pass.
Here's Brett Maher, who connected from 32 with the win. This one's 27. Into the win. Enough leg and no problem. Swing easy when it's breezy. 7-6 Penn State early in the second quarter here in Lincoln.
I'm Robert Flores with his Taco Bell studio update. Texas A&M is leading number one Alabama 14-0. Watch Johnny Manziel loses the football, scrambles, find Ryan Swope at the back of the end zone, and the Aggies are near midfield looking for more.
All right, Robert, thank you. Penn State leading 7-6. First possession, Nebraska had first and goal at the 6. Their second possession, first and goal at the 8 on both occasions. Penn State defense held them to a field goal try. Maher's 2-for-2. What a kick that is into the 35-mile-an-hour wind. Jesse Della Valle downs it. Matt McGloin in the Penn State offense back on the field right after this. Take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. Two possessions for each team so far, and they're marching up and down the field. Penn State 155 yards of offense in its two possessions, and Nebraska 146, including 103 on the ground. A big key. Both teams very good on third down. Penn State a perfect 3-for-3. Play action pass by Matt McGloin, chased by Jason Anker, throws and caught for a first down by Jesse James. Another of those talented young Penn State tight ends, true freshman from Glassport, PA.
Nice job by Matt McGloin, staying patient, even feeling the pressure from Anker and trusting the big 6'7 target to make a play, even though Compton had decent coverage. Patience by McGloin.
Comes out throwing again. Anker got a hand up, flag thrown perhaps for a hold, and McGloin threw it away in the general direction of Jesse James. Anker has been a force in the pass rush and has forced a couple of holding penalties by this Penn State offense.
Holding. Offense number 78. 10 yards from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
Right there you see Farrell, number 78. Hands inside. He's all right. He's just got his hands a little bit high. Then he pulls the jersey. His hands were in pretty good position to start, but you can't yank the jersey. And Nebraska felt, Sean, coming into this game, that they like their one-on-one matchups against the Penn State tackles.
Couple of penalties already on Farrell. McGloin hands it off to Michael Zordich. Moves to the 30-yard line. Justin Blatchford, who plays in extra defensive back situation, senior, made the tackle.
In second and long, as a defense, you always alert any type of screen pass or draw. It's an automatic rule. Now they put their receivers inside here to put pressure on the safeties. These are wide receivers matched up inside, and their tight ends' exchange positions are lined up outside.
McGloin, a slant, incomplete. Intended for Matt Lehman. Broken up by Andrew Green. Third down and 16.
And the reason you do that, you want your receivers, Sean, lined up on linebackers or safeties. And you want your tight ends matched up on the smaller corners. And that time, Andrew Green did a good job of boxing out Lehman.
Perfection on third down to be put to the test here. Third and 16. And a timeout called by Nebraska. With 11:27 left in the first half. Here at Nebraska's Trauma Mechanics Engineering School, researchers doing work testing combat helmets. After the Cornhuskers timeout, third down and 16. McLaurin blitzed by Blatchford, and Matt threw it away.
Blatchford's going to come off the top of your corner. Watch 89 Gilliam right here. He goes inside. He's got help here. He's got to come off and get Blatchford quicker. He does not recognize the blitz by Blatchford. See him step inside. He has no chance right now, and the speedy Blatchford forces Matt McLaurin to throw it away.
First punt of this game from Alex Butterworth. And a lot of help on the bounce and roll. And a 56-yard punt. Tonight on ABC's Saturday Night Football, the undefeated Fighting Irish look to continue their quest for perfection. Manti Te'o in Notre Dame taking on the Boston College Eagles. The Eagles have upset them on a number of occasions over the years. 1993, 2002, among the examples of that. That's tonight. Saturday Night Football presented by Windows 8 from the great city of Boston. Taylor Martinez, the toss back to Abdullah. And another tackle for a loss by this Penn State defense. Mike Hull up from his linebacker spot after Sean Stanley threw the play off kilter.
You're right, Sean. Mike Hull does a good job. Tackles for losses, 8 so far today, which is outstanding. A lot of it's due to the defensive end. Sean Stanley got the penetration and made Abdullah run east and west as opposed to north and south.
Marked the ball basically at the line of scrimmage. Second down and 10. Martinez caught by Kyler Reed, and he's upended immediately by Stephon Morris. Gained to the 17-yard line. And a third down for Nebraska, 4 out of 6 on third down today, 3rd and 7. Mike Hull, the linebacker, running in coverage. So a 3 and out. It was Anthony Zettel who put good pressure on the quarterback, Martinez.
Good job by Martinez to stepping in and making the throw, and just overthrows Turner, who's matched up on Hull, and you'll take that matchup. Tim Beckwood, the offensive coordinator, all day long. Just could not execute and complete the pass.
Then Maher to punt into a 35 mile per hour wind. Penn State should get excellent field position out of this. Jesse Della Valle. Brings it back to the 35 yard line. Justin Blatchford made the tackle. 31 yard punt. They had a 13-yard return, 85,527. The attendance, officially the 324th straight sellout here. Every game for 50 years, filled the capacity. I know, Chris, we both feel the same way. There isn't a place in America we enjoy going more than Memorial Stadium. These fans are in here an hour before the game, in their seats, watching the warm-ups. Zordich. Headed inside, but buried after a gain of 3 by Baker Steinkuhler and Andrew Green.
Yeah, you wonder when we're going to see Zach Zwinak Not seen him since he put the ball on the turf. Zordich, more known as a fullback as opposed to a single back or a tailback type runner.
Good throw to Allen Robinson, and he has a first down. At the 23, Sean Fisher made the tackle on the sophomore Robinson, a 10-yard gain.
Yeah, getting ways to get the ball into the hands of your playmakers. Quick screen to Robinson, knowing that you have the big 6'7 Jesse James out there blocking on the corner. Positive yards, good call by Bill O'Brien.
And his four catches away from a single-season record shared at the moment by O.J. McDuffie and Bobby Engram, 63 apiece. Deonte Evans stopped Michael Zordich close to the line of scrimmage.
That's what Coach O'Brien does, Sean. They don't do a heck of a lot of plays. They do a lot of formations to confuse defenses. It's a credit to him and his staff and the players to pick up this offense quickly and execute it at such a high level, starting with number 11, Matt McGloin.
The last road game of the year, they're 3-0 on the road in the Big Ten. McGloin running out of time with a flag thrown intended for Zordich and incomplete. David Santos, the freshman linebacker in coverage. Hands to the face against the defense. Penalties and turnovers have hurt Bo Pelini's Huskers all season long.
Personal foul. Hands to the face. Defense number 55. Half the distance from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
It's amazing, Chris, that they have the record they do, 7-2, when they're one of the worst in the country in turnovers and penalties.
All right, and you see right there, Baker Steinkuhler getting his hands right up into the face.
And no doubt, Ty Howell, backup guard in the game.
That's discipline. That's one thing that does bother Bo, because he is a disciplined coach. Those penalties have been something that hurts him.
Seven penalties per game for Nebraska in the last 2 weeks. They had 8 against Michigan for 104 yards. They had 9 last week in their win at Michigan State. What helped them is the Spartans also had 100 yards in penalties in that game. Matt McGloin saying the play clock didn't reset. John O'Neill is not swayed. Against Penn State. Nebraska's been flagged 3 times. Bill O'Brien taking up McGloin's cause to no avail. After the play fake, McGloin, plenty of time, runs out of bounds. Good coverage. David Santos chased him out.
Again, we see what they like to do. They run the zone read, the old-fashioned zone read with a single back, where they give the ball to the back about 6 yards deep and he picks from tackle to tackle to which hole to go. Then they always have the play action off of it, and especially in the red zone because of the big targets at 6'6 and 6'7, the big size. They're like a front line on the basketball team, the tight ends for the Nittany Lions.
McGloin got 6 with the run. 8 minutes to go, first half. Penn State trying to add to its 7-6 lead. A blitz off the corner, and Sean Fisher, the blitzer, dumped Zordich immediately.
We had a chance to talk with Sean Fisher yesterday as he timed that blitz. Interviewed this past week with Chicago Medical School at Chicago University.
He was a perfect 4-0 student. He wants to go to med school. Bo Pelini let him miss a day of practice last week to fly down to Chicago and interview at the University of Chicago Med School. He wants to be a plastic surgeon. Going to apply to other schools as well.
I volunteered you for the first patient.
I'd probably be a candidate. 3rd and 9, they could get a first down just shy of the 1 yard line.
There's the 6'7 target, Jesse James.
Timing a little bit off on the snap, so the lineman didn't move, and the pass is incomplete. Over the head of Jesse James with Andrew Green in coverage. Here's Quint Kesnick.
This will be an interesting kick for Ficken, who really didn't take any warm-up kicks. I've never seen a kid go out there cold on the sideline, not using the net. Keep in mind, in the first kickoff of the game, he injured his eye. He's been sitting with sunglasses on the entire first half.
His start to the year was a disaster. He opened the year hitting just two out of his first eight. But he's made three in a row and five out of six. 7 out of 14 for the year. 27-yard try. Good for him. I mean, a lot of guys would have just gone completely in the tank, Chris, with the way his season started. He had four misses in their one-point loss at Virginia. But he is much better now. And the lead's back to four for Penn State. Tonight on ESPN, also live on Watch ESPN.
How about that week Barner had last week? 300-plus and five touchdowns?
Mm.
He's still tired.
Oregon has scored at least 42 points in all nine of their games this season. That is tied with the Oregon team from 2 years ago for the longest such streak to start a season in major college history. And it was the California Golden Bears 2 years ago that held Oregon to just 15 points. So, you know, Chip Kelly wants to go down there and put it on the Bears tonight. Also help them in the BCS standings. A little more love perhaps from the computers. Ficken with the wind at his back. Gets a line drive. Down by Kenny Bell. Here's Robert Flores.
All right, Sean, Dr. Pepper conference update, and we've got an upset brewing in the SEC, and it is a big one. Christian Michael, second touchdown run of the game, and Texas A&M leading Alabama 20-0. Tide have 34 total yards.
Wow. There's some talk during the week, Chris, about perhaps a hangover for Alabama after that dramatic come-from-behind win, the final moments of the game last week against LSU in Baton Rouge.
The LSU exposed a little vulnerabilities. Mettenberger went off on him.
Nebraska not quite as good on first down as it usually is. Martinez, good decision to keep it. Abdullah would have been smothered. Martinez showing his great speed. Ted Roof, the Penn State defensive coordinator, said Taylor Martinez is a jet, and he just got 11 yards.
Well, Penn State had difficulty defending the last running back they played, quarterback running back, and Braxton Miller. And you would think to get this running game going a little bit that Taylor Martinez would start running the ball with some called runs as there.
Here took over that game 2 weeks ago in Happy Valley. Abdullah gets two. Mike Hull knocked him down. That loss to Ohio State, the only defeat for Penn State in the last seven games.
Tempo also got Penn State against Ohio State. Right now, they've responded well to the first half tempo of Nebraska.
Martinez, Pagnano blitzes from the corner, and the throw is high off the hands of Kenny Bell. Adrian Amos had the coverage.
That's usually a catch that Kenny Bell will make.
Third down and eight. Martinez, shot puts it ahead for Abdullah. And he's out of bounds, shy of the first down. He managed to stay inbound to get to the 42. But about 4 yards short of the first down.
Speed off the edge is killing Nebraska right now. You're going to see Gerald Hodges, number six, just beat Andrew Rodriguez, which forced the bad throw of Taylor Martinez to scramble toward the screen. Usually you don't want to run toward the screen, but he's scrambling toward the screen because of Hodges' speed rush off the outside, beating Rodriguez, the offensive tackle.
Red Maher punting into the wind again. His last run in this direction went 31 yards. Rugby-style kick this time. Line drive. Fielded by Evan Lewis. And well covered by Nebraska. Graham Stoddard made the tackle. 30-yard punt. And a return of three. ESPN is joining the USO to give to the USO Wish Book and send gifts that will lift the spirits of our troops and their families. Team up with ESPN and the USO. Go to www.uso.org/ESPN. You can select a gift such as a family fun day or free phone cards to give to our troops and their families. The USO Wish Book. Great way to let our heroes and their families know that we support them. 10-6, Penn State in the ball for the Nittany Lions. Starting this possession from their own 32, Bill Belton in at running back. Gets his first carry in 2 weeks. And is dropped for a loss by the penetrating Andrew Green.
Did not play. Get a carry last week, and Coach O'Brien sets the precedent. It's all about practice. Zwinak put the ball on the ground. Belton getting an opportunity.
I haven't seen Zach Zwinak since he fumbled when it looked like Penn State was going in to score a touchdown. Matt McGloin hands it off to Belton, former wide receiver. And he got stood up by P.J. Smith, the senior safety, coming off a career-high 12 tackles last week at Michigan State. Took a lot of ribbing from his teammates this week. He got the short end of a big collision with Le'Veon Bell.
See Bo Pelini getting on Santos right there. The reason being is coverage. They weren't very sound. They did not know what they were doing. Santos looked confused. It's tough. I mean, Bo, it's very difficult to play the matchup zones that Nebraska plays. And you have to constantly rep it and get it and not think about it. You could see the communication going on between the linebackers, between Compton and Santos. I think Compton's probably right, Santos is probably wrong, and it's tough to play a talented guy like that if he doesn't know where he's going.
Last play did not count. Nebraska apparently called a timeout just before the snap. There's that collision we talked about last week. Wow. E.J. Smith said his helmet went back on his head and then snapped back into its proper position when he hit the ground. They won the game. PJ was all right, so the teammates had a lot of fun watching the film of that one during the week. Matt McGloin on second and 11 throws incomplete. Headed for Brandon Mosby Felder. Again, well covered by Andrew Green.
Well, that's the matchup zone that we talk about. Now, I'm going to give credit to not only Green, but Santos right away took away the first option where Matt McGloin was looking. He was looking for Matt Lehman out in the flat. And Santos did his job, and that's what Bo Pelini wants to do. And he'll get on guys, but he'll also pat him on the back the next play. It's just how he coaches, and he does a great job of doing it.
They were 3-for-3 on third down. They failed to convert on their last two. Third and 11 for the Nittany Lions from their own 31. 5 minutes to go in the first half. Nebraska rushed four. McGloin throws incomplete. Intended for Brandon Mosby Felder. Josh Mitchell in coverage for the Huskers.
Big stop for the Husker defense. Trying to create some type of field position for their own. Matt McGloin a little early on that throw. Mosby Felder did not get his head around. Actually, the ball was on target.
Alex Butterworth to punt. Tim Barlow's back deep. And he muffs the punt. And it is recovered by Penn State, by Mike Hall. I was just about to say that Marlow was a question mark coming into the game. He's had a shoulder injury, re-aggravated last week. You see him getting up slowly again. And one of the reasons they dressed him is he's their most sure-handed punt catcher. And on this breezy day, they wanted to make sure they had somebody who could field the punt. Well, that plan didn't work out so well.
Yeah, you just see right away. When you feel that pressure, his eyes left the ball at the last second. And Hall, a valuable contributor on this Penn State defense and special teams. Great play.
Zwinak back in the game now. He's served his penance after the fumble. He was taken down by P.J. Smith. Gain to two. Here's Quint.
Guys, I talked to Tim Marlow before the game. I was really surprised to see him in uniform. He did not practice on Thursday. I said, Tim, are you going to give it a go? He said, yeah, I'm going to give it a shot. I'll probably just return punts. He had the collarbone injury, but then his left shoulder was separated twice last week in the game. Didn't practice. There you see the mistake.
Zwinak again. Bangs forward, runs over David Santos, who is the primary tackler.
Regardless, though, Penn State is staying on schedule. Coaches refer to staying on schedule, and you're at third and five, third and six, third and seven. That's a comfort zone for Bill O'Brien. He's got a host of plays that he goes to on his chart, and the plays that he trusts that Matt McGloin will make for him.
And perhaps in four down territory here, Marlow hoping the defense can bail him out after the muff punt. I know he's their most sure-handed guy, but putting a guy out there who hasn't practiced all week would certainly be questioned.
Fires for the foul. Nebraska called a timeout. The third and final. A 30-second timeout.
They're having trouble on defense getting situated, and they're out of timeouts.
When you see 11 guys walk the line of scrimmage
as brothers,
as a family
that represents every ounce of hard work
given in the classroom,
in the weight room,
in the community,
on the practice field.
Big Ten football is not just about Saturdays.
Oh, no. Well, that's just part of the story.
It's every day.
All year. Our whole lives.
Big Ten chess, all three.
Big Ten football.
Big Ten football.
Big Ten football.
Big Ten football.
Reason for the timeout. They're six. They're six. Six plus six equals 12. You can only play 11. That's the third mental error as far as coverage or getting the right personnel on for Nebraska. And that's why they've taken three timeouts on the defensive side of the ball.
Third down and six. Might be four down territory. Thicken's longest field goal of the year is just 34 yards. McGloin zings one for a first down. As you said, Chris, that's why they're in their comfort zone of that down and distance, because their passing game, primarily the short intermediate passes, well suited to pick up that down and distance.
Yeah, and again, Allen Robinson commands so much respect as they go to hurry up snap.
Looked like Nebraska too many men on the field. They were also offside, apparently. Boy, they're having a nightmare.
Offside. Defense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
With the defensive substitutions.
Well, that's the reason why they're trying to get dime personnel on third downs. Then they're going back to regular personnel with four down linemen, three linebackers on running downs or first downs. You cannot do that because that's a smart coach and a smart quarterback. Hurry up, line up, snap the ball. Easy flag. Easy 5 yards.
Well, penalties and turnovers a problem again for Nebraska. The muff punt gives Penn State this opportunity. Swing it. Upended by Ciante Evans, the junior from Arlington, Texas. 3 minutes to go in the half.
Yeah, old school for Zwinak. Nothing on the arms, no tape, no pads. Just go.
6'1", 232-pounder, sophomore out of Frederick, Maryland. McGloin in the flat, caught. Jesse James, touchdown. Jesse James, the freshman. 11th catch of the year. Four of them have gone for touchdowns. Their tight ends have caught more passes than any team in the country. And Marlowe, still with his head down, the muff punt set this up. Sam Thicken, the extra point.
Little surprise, Sean, this work. I'm going to tell you why. Last week against Purdue, Jesse James lined up as a fullback in the I-back position. Both times against Purdue, Jesse James did this. Now, as Nebraska, you think you're ready for that play because that's all they've shown. And there he is, releasing right to the flat. A miscommunication in coverage. You have Mosby Felder in there picking people off. Watch Mosby Felder throw the little pick right there. You have miscommunication between Fisher and Compton, and Jesse James knows how to finish when he gets into the red zone, a true freshman and a big target. But that's tendencies. I mean, he lines up at fullback. That's right now 4 for 4 that they threw the ball to Jesse James in the flat.
In the first half, dominance continues for Penn State. 154-39 in the first half. Then again, Nebraska shown the knack for coming from behind in the second half. Three wins in Big Ten play this year when they were double digits down. That's Wisconsin, Northwestern, and dramatically last week at Michigan State when they rallied from 10 down in the fourth quarter to win on a touchdown with 6 seconds to go. Sam Thicken, the touchback. Nebraska will begin at the 25.
I'm thinking if you're a Nebraska fan, the thing you don't worry about is that you know you're comfortable in this position. At least you know you can come back when you're down.
Damian Stafford and Bo Pelini, an unpleasant exchange. that is hollering at the players, but then again, when you have this many problems with getting the defense on the field, the right alignment, the right people, and the right number of people, the sideline has to bear some responsibility for that as well. The pass intended for Kyler Reed incomplete.
Absolutely, and we'll see if that has any carryover effect. And Bo Pelini, again, he's a very intense guy. He's got to settle Damian Stafford down. He's a valuable member of that defense because he gets some people lined up back there.
Also talking to Will Compton, who's the leader of that defense. Now very quiet now. Body blitz. Stanley a factor again. Martinez runs away. Gets rid of it. Low throw. Intended for Kenny Bell. Incomplete. He's trying to convince the officials that he caught the ball. They don't agree.
One area where they're missing Rex Burkhead is pass protection. You see Amir Abdullah try to cut Mike Motti. Mike Motti does a good job of clearing his knees.
Did he get the hands out of that ball?
Tough to tell from that angle.
No replay stoppage. Martinez, run for his last five, has his man. And then the ball knocked out by Adrian Amos as Jamal Turner couldn't hang on. They roll it an incomplete pass. Boy, watching the Purdue game last week, Amos had a couple of really big hits. And here's a key big blow to prevent a big gainer for Nebraska and force a punt.
Yeah, the reason why I like it, Sean, he's coming in there with the shoulder and not his helmet. Being smart. See him lead with that shoulder and not his helmet, and he's able to get the collision that he wants to jar the ball loose. Not only a good hit, but a smart hit, not leading with the head.
Well, could have been ruled a catch and then a fumble. Very close to possession established by Jamal Turner. Now another rugby punt. It's a shank. Off to the right. Flag thrown late on the near sideline. Flag was thrown after the punt went out of bounds. They're going to mark it at the 41-yard line. Sixteen-yard punt if it stands.
Personal foul. Sideline interference. Penn State sideline. 15 yards from the end of the run. First down.
Wow. Well, it was the field judge, Terry Anderson, who threw the flag. At least he was doing the explaining to the referee, John O'Neill.
See, that happens down the field. You see him come in from the top of your screen when we showed the replay.
Well, you don't see that called very often.
No.
You'd have to think it was something pretty major to warrant the flag being thrown.
Well, here's the other thing, Sean. Usually you get a warning first, so that sideline might have been warned.
And that's usually they announce the sideline warnings.
That's true.
Remember hearing one? I don't.
No,
maybe
I don't.
It happened, we didn't hear it.
No. But also, though, they usually have one coach that's absolutely designated to get him back. He's the get him back coach. Every team has one.
Ooh, McLoyne caught the snap, flagged down. That's going to be against Penn State. We saw the exact same thing in the Ohio State game 2 weeks ago. McLoyne was moving toward the line of scrimmage, and it's an illegal shift. Go back to the sideline interference.
Keep your eye right here. Let's see where the interference comes from. Oh, man. I mean, the play was dead, and guys were just kind of moving toward the line of scrimmage. To me, at least, it looks like
that was Matt McLoyne. Yeah. That was kind of ticky-tack, if you ask me.
Because they're kind of just coming out because the ball was kicked and shanked out of bounds, and so they're just going to take the field.
Second and 10. Screen is Winnack. Good block by Ty Holm. Here goes Winnack again. They haven't been a big play offense, but there's one. Damian Stafford made the tackle. It is a 31-yard game.
Yeah, screen away from the trips, and here they go to their NASCAR after a big play. They like to hand it off to Zwinak.
And they do. scrimmage. Winds up an 8-yard gain, under 2 minutes to go. And all three timeouts left for Penn State. Chance to really open it up before the half.
Yeah, and a bad sign for Nebraska as Winnex getting back, bouncing to the huddle. They're getting up off the ground slow.
And he left it to substitute with all the problems they've had. Winnex taken down by Wilt Compton. Now, Bo Pelini took a phone call on his radio show the other night from a fan who was basically chastising him for his sideline demeanor and yelling at the players, and Bo handled it very gracefully. And Wilt Compton said to us the other day, you know, we don't mind it. It happens from time to time, but he also loves us up all the time, too. Comes with the territory. Third down and one. McGloin throws over the head of Matt Lehman. Fourth and one. What will they do? Thicken's been better lately. But they love to go for the fourth downs, in large part because of the field goal problems early in the year. They're 16 out of 30 for the year. They've made more fourth down conversions than any other Big Ten team has attempted.
I think he has confidence in his offense to go for it. And Zwinak normally is reliable to get you the tough yard.
The groin keeps, but there's a flag down for a procedure penalty against the Nittany Lions.
Full start. Offense. Penalty, still fourth down.
And will they stick with the offense on the field on fourth and six? And Penn State's going to take a moment to think about it. From here, it would be about a 38-yard field goal. Thicken's long is 34. He does have the strong wind behind his back. We're seeing some key penalties on both sides. More of the same for Nebraska. The problems all year with turnovers and penalties, but unusual for Penn State to hurt itself.
Yeah, and especially in that type of situation. But you look at it and decide whether to go for it or not. I think you've got a little bit of a rhythm. You might as well go for it. Your defense is playing well. If you don't get it, you got a minute 12 less and you got them backed up, so there's not really a threat that Nebraska can go down and score just because you have confidence in your defense.
Been a very interesting game between these two proud programs. 1 year after they played in the first game for Penn State, after everything broke out, Jerry Sandusky being charged a few days later, Joe Paterno fired, and just a couple of days after that, Nebraska and Penn State met at Beaver Stadium on a day many described as surreal. Another Penn State timeout. They had the offense on the field. Players and coaches on both sides we spoke with during the week said they will never forget this moment. The teams meeting at midfield, joined together in prayer. The incredible silence is what so many of the participants remember. Nebraska took a 17-0 lead on the Rex Burkhead touchdown. Penn State battled back. Two rushing touchdowns by Stephon Green. But the Husker defense stiffened, stopping the Nittany Lions on a couple of fourth down plays on Penn State's next two possessions. And Nebraska held on to win on a very emotional day. Tom Bradley's first game as the interim coach. Of course, during the week, there was some question as to whether or not the game would be played, if Nebraska would even make the trip. They decided to go, and Bo Pelini said he was blown away by the reaction from the folks in a very positive way at Penn State. 38-yard try by Thicken, and he cannot miss. Well, he went from the worst kicker in the country to the hottest kicker in the country.
Just showing the confidence growing with Bill O'Brien and his kicker Sam Thicken by allowing him to kick and get points on the board before half. We were out there a couple weeks ago, Sean. We watched him kick in practice, and he's pretty solid in practice.
He's got a strong leg, not a very big guy, but he does have a decent leg. And Bill O'Brien really admires the way the young man has hung with it. Hasn't let it just totally destroy him. Very good student. First, they lost Anthony Farrah, one of the players who transferred out when the NCAA told the Penn State players they could leave and be eligible to play right away. It's part of the very severe sanctions handed down by the NCAA, the Penn State program, including four-year postseason ban. They are not eligible to play in the Big Ten championship game. or in a bowl game. Congratulations to Wisconsin, by the way, with their victory today. They have clinched their division in the Big Ten championship game. There are some of the penalties assessed to Penn State.
That's the one that gets me, Sean, because it's almost like Coach O'Brien has to go and recruit his players all over again during the year, because they could transfer out all the way up until the start of training camp in August. That's crazy.
Yeah, they have until the start of summer practice next August to transfer without having to sit out a year, so it's possible more Penn State players could leave the program. One of the key departures was Anthony Farrah, the field goal kicker and punter who went to Texas. With the wind, picking booms on the back of the end zone. Tanny Bell doesn't try to run it out. We mentioned Wisconsin will represent the leaders' division, even though Ohio State and Penn State are ahead of them. Both of those teams are ineligible to go to the championship game because of NCAA sanctions. They would be recognized, either the Buckeyes or the Nittany Lions, if they won the leaders' division. And Ohio State would clinch at least a share of that division with the Penn State loss today. But at the moment, they're not getting any help. And the Cornhuskers, Ohio State's idol for the first time this season. This weekend, Amir Abdullah fights to the 32, but no timeouts left for Nebraska because of their problems getting lined up on defense. Martinez's pass batted down by Anthony Settle. Impressive freshman, I mean, more and more of a factor week to week for the Lions.
And when you have a three-step drop, you know, quick throw like that, you want to try to cut his knees out for one reason and one reason only, so he does not get up there and block the shot.
Third down and three. Nebraska might be forced to punt into the wind again if they don't convert here. Pete Massaro came on the outside rush. Martinez stepped inside, got the first down. They're at the 41. 9-yard gain. Lack of the timeouts really hurting Nebraska here. False start against Nebraska.
And they're having to take a long time to get the ball snapped. Taylor Martinez takes a long time before he claps, which tells the center that he's ready. And their seconds are going tick, 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 tick.
Ball start. Offense number 71. 5-yard penalty. Still first down. That foul comes with a 10-second subtraction. Please set the game clock to 17 seconds.
Jeremiah Searles called for a second penalty of the half and the fifth against Nebraska. Time for Martinez. Throws short to Abdullah. He's tackled immediately by Mike Hull. And that'll be the end of the first half. ...255 yards of offense for Penn State and a 20-6 lead. Coming up, stay tuned for a complete halftime report right after these messages. Back in Lincoln, Nebraska, the Cornhuskers and the Penn State Nittany Lions getting ready for the second half. Penn State leading 20-6 at the break. They have 255 yards of offense in the first half, averaged 7 yards per play. And obviously, Chris, big problem for Nebraska on defense in that first half. They didn't get lined up in the correct places often. They had trouble getting the personnel on and off the field. And when they were lined up, they couldn't stop them.
Yeah, it cost them 3 timeouts. And it's alignment and assignment, and it's communication. It's communication amongst the players on the field. It's communication from the sideline to the field. That's not getting done. Bo Pelini will make sure that's addressed at halftime. And we'll see if they can take it from the locker room to the field. You're Penn State, Sean. Just do what you're doing. You're up 20-6, and you're playing balanced football on both sides of the ball.
Sam Ficken will kick off. With the wind at his back, Bo Pelini won the toss, elected to defer. He said he likes to get the ball first in the second half. His team will be going into that gusty breeze, 35 miles per hour, in the third quarter. In the second quarter, going into the wind, they had four possessions, three punts, and then the half ended in their fourth possession. They had no success going in this direction, just 62 yards of offense in the second quarter. Touchback on Ficken's kickoff as we take a look at our Pacific Light game summary. Matt McGloin to Jesse James for a touchdown. 10 out of 18 for 160 for McGloin, and seven tackles for a loss. Deion Barnes, the sack there, particularly in the red zone, inside the 10-yard line twice. Nebraska penetrated and was forced to kick field goals. Toss to Amir Abdullah. Stumbled to the outside. Taken across the boundary by Stephon Morris. Gain of five. Here's Quint Kessner.
Sean, three things stood out talking about Pelini as he's coming out of the locker room. Number one, he said overall execution, both sides of the ball has been lacking. Really bemoaning his special teams. You think about the poor field position, the poor punts, the fumbled punt return. He said that was killer. And then communication versus Penn State's no huddle. Personnel packages, they have struggled with that.
Indeed they have. Poor field position, a problem for Nebraska today. The average start, the 21-yard line. Abdullah, nice bounce to the outside. Spins down to the 39, wrapped up by Malcolm Willis, who's injured on the play. First down, Nebraska.
The whole deal with Abdullah, the more reps that he gets, the more patient he becomes in allowing the holes to develop before him, staying a patient runner and trusting that his offensive line will sustain those blocks. Watch his eyes right here. Just the patience. He knows he's getting a toss. It can go inside or outside. He's getting a good lead block. Right there it's not inside, but he sees the hole outside, and he has a nice little burst. And actually, his size helps him, Sean. That Nebraska offensive line is huge. And I can tell you from a former linebacker that I'd much rather play against the bigger, taller running backs as opposed to those little short guys. They hide behind there. You can't find them. And you just got to read blocking schemes. But Amir Abdullah, really an outstanding back and getting a chance to shine with Rex Burkhead being on the mend.
First and 10, Nebraska from the 39-yard line.
Willis walked off under his own power. As always, the fans here in Lincoln with polite applause for the opponent. Abdullah remains the running back. He's up to 80 yards rushing now. Well, good cut. He's done a good job of identifying the holes and running through them. Glenn Carson pulled him down at the 45, a pickup of six.
It'll be interesting to see when Tim Beck, the offensive coordinator, decides to get Taylor Martinez more involved on called runs as far as the running game goes for the Cornhuskers.
Martinez is rushed for 41 yards today. Looks one out to Kenny Bell, is yanked down by Michael Motti in Penn State territory at the 46. First catch of the day for Kenny Bell, their leading receiver, is 34th of the year.
And Ted Roof coming with a corner blitz and a good read by both Bell and Martinez on the hot read.
Right through the arms of the blitzing corner, Adrian Amos, who almost knocked it down. Martinez drifts back, wants to throw deep and dies, and a good catch by Bell. On the ball behind him at the 24-yard line. First down.
Actually intended for Anunua right here, who's Motti does a job of tipping it, getting a good job in the depth in his position. Kenny Bell securing the catch after the Anunua tip.
22-yard gain.
Coming with a toss sweep out of this formation.
Option look, Martinez keeps it. Took a whack, that wrestled down by Gerald Hodges. Sean Stanley also involved in the play. Second down at eight. They've done a nice job of keeping Martinez in check on the run. He ran for 205 last week against Michigan State. Second 200-yard plus rushing game of his career. Come here, Charles! In that 59-71, the two longest runs of the season against Michigan State. Here's a nifty run inside the five, and he extended for the end zone and didn't get there. They'll spot it at the one. 21 yards on the run, first and goal, Nebraska.
You see right here where he's down short of the goal line, but that was a called run by Tim Beck, and it takes patience by Martinez to pump fake the throw to Cotton. Cotton was jumped by the middle linebacker who vacated the middle, which allowed Martinez to shoot through that hole. Excellent call by Tim Beck. Good patience by Martinez with the pump fake.
They've been inside the 10-yard line twice. Both times had to kick field goals. Amani Cross, a powerfully built freshman, is the tailback. They give it to him. Touchdown, Nebraska. 225-pounder Cross pounds it in the end zone. Impressive start to the second half for Nebraska. Going into that gusty wind, they go 75 yards in eight plays in 3-12.
Good mix of run and pass to keep that Penn State Nittany Lion defense off balance. Caught a break with the tip drill from Anunua to Kenny Bell on the long pass.
Maher for the extra point. And it's a 7-point game. Monty Cross, his third touchdown of his freshman season, set up by the run by Taylor Martinez. Huskers on the comeback trail again. Back in Lincoln, Nebraska, the Huskers accustomed to this situation. Three times already in Big Ten play this year, they've rallied from double digits down to the second half for victory. They're the only FBS team in the country to have done that three times. They know here in Lincoln it's not over until it's over. And that's a big reason why. Taylor Martinez, the running and passing skills to bring a team back.
So he's not one of the most prettiest guys that we've seen all year as far as his style, but he is good. He is an excellent college quarterback, a guy that I would take. I mean, really, his ability, he's accurate with the ball, and he's so explosive running the football.
That wasn't the most prettiest sentence you've ever uttered either.
Oh, well, get used to those.
No, it's so shocking because you're usually such a grammarian.
Yes, thank you.
Ben Maher's kickoff down to Jesse Della Valle. Oh, that rocked at the 20-yard line. Lonzo Whaley leading the charge.
When I use the word prettiest, I usually don't put most in front of it. Thank you, Sean. I'll make sure I'll check you.
Well, you usually get under control. Aerial coverage of today's game provided by MetLife. See how MetLife can provide the coverage you need. MetLife. I can do this. Can Penn State do this with the noise ratcheted back up at Memorial Stadium? Zach Zwinak. Good gain on first down. Got about five. And he's approaching another 100-yard game. Derek Martin, the defensive end from Moreno Valley, California, made the tackle. 86 yards rushing now for Zwinak. Had three 100-yard games this season. Boy, late movement again by the Nebraska defense. McGloin is going to be sacked. Baker Steinkuhler with the push up the middle.
Working on Diffenbach, number 65. You're going to see big Baker Steinkuhler right here coming from the right. Let's see what happens, what move he throws on him. Just a straight bull rush, tosses him to the side. That's when he gets low at 6'6". He's powerful, 290 pounds, and as I always say, low man wins. He was the low man. He won.
First sack of the day for Nebraska. Third and 15. Good protection from the Penn State offensive line, and McGloin through an interception. Damian Stafford brings it back to the four-yard line. That's the fourth interception thrown by
McGloin this year. And the second interception for Damian Stafford, who brought it back 22 yards.
This is the matchup coverage that we talked about. The communication problem seemed to have been taken care of in the locker room. Damian Stafford on the help route inside, jumps the underneath route. Matt McGloin never sees him. And Damian Stafford, big play for the Cornhusker defense.
He was the one waving his finger in the face of Bo Pelini in an ugly exchange in the first half. Undoubtedly, they're happier now. First and goal. Johnny Cross kept powering, got to the two. He's a freshman, but powerfully built. When he arrived on campus, he did 41 pull-ups, which immediately got the attention of his teammates. And he looks older. When he was here for a visit as a recruit, Jamal Turner, one of the Cornhusker players, asked him if he was the dad of one of the recruits.
Yeah, they found the money down there in Georgia. Jumped on him late. Saw they liked what he brings to the table. Powerful run on Monte Cross.
Ordinarily be Rex Burkhead down here around the goal line. They give it across again. Touchdown. And an extra point away from a tie game. Cole Pensick, the guard, leading the way with a nice block.
That's a great call, Sean, because he had a decleater and a knockdown that opened a hole for Cross.
Penn State scored 10 points in the final 2:42 of the first half. Nebraska, two touchdowns in the first 2:11. We're in the last 2 minutes, 11 seconds. In the first 5 minutes plus of the third quarter. And Maher's extra point has tied it. Damian Stafford's interception set it up. And it's a new game in Lincoln. Established in 1881, the Yankee Hill Brick Company here in Lincoln manufactures clay face bricks and pavers, locally mined clay. Companies produce more than 80% of the bricks used on the buildings here at the University of Nebraska. An historic Memorial Stadium rocking as Nebraska scored two quick touchdowns here in the third quarter. They were down by two touchdowns at the half. It's 20-20. 9:37 to go in the third quarter. Brett Maher will kick off into the wind, which is still howling out of the south. Expected to turn around from the north tonight. 77 at kickoff. It won't get out of the 30s here tomorrow, according to the forecast. Some nasty weather expected here later tonight. Nice boot into the breeze. Trevor Williams took a knee. Let's go back and look at the game-tying touchdown.
505 pounds can open up holes. Take a look right here. Hall, number 43, does not have a chance because nobody on Penn State knocks off the pullers. And you see Hall get ejected from the saloon. No chance against 505 pounds. And you have the big 225-pound Imani Cross following that up. Well executed by Nebraska.
Cole Pensick, former walk-on. He was a center. And one day they were in practice. They were running low on guards. There wasn't a guard in the game. He just ran on the field into the practice. The next day, the coaches said, hey, you did pretty well. What do you think about playing some guard? Kind of made himself into a guard, and he's becoming a good one. Alex Kenny for Penn State advances out to the 33-yard line. Gain of 8. Second down and 2. Zwinak wanted to hear the likely audible. Flags thrown. And they're all.
That's number 60. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
Out of sorts right now. Here's Quint Kesnick.
Prior to this Penn State possession, head coach Bill O'Brien brought the entire offense together behind the bench. Said, we had our moments, they just had theirs. Have poise, have composure, deal with it. We've got to manage the momentum.
McGloin's done such a good job this year of avoiding the big mistakes.
The interception led to the game-tying touchdown. He throws low and incomplete. 10 for Brandon Mosby Felder off his career-high 129 yards receiving on six catches at Purdue last week.
Damian Stafford's reading routes. He's playing on the outside shoulder of Felder. Felder had the inside part of the field open, and they're jumping routes. That's what Bo Pelini teaches. That's what they're doing. At times it's risky, but at other times there's big payoffs, just like the last series.
Third down and seven. Penn State offense could really use a big play and a third down conversion, and they'll get it on the catch by Alex Kenny, sophomore from State College, former state sprint champion in high school, yanked down by Ciante Evans, but it's a first down to the 35-yard line. Got just the seven they needed.
Timeout for an injured player.
Like Ciante Evans is the injured player.
One of the things you do to play against matchup zones is you run crossing routes. And that's exactly what they did on Ciante Evans, because you know that there's no press coverage because you're worried about the pick. So when there's no press, the adjustment for the offensive receiver is to run crossing routes to beat his man across the field. Exactly what they did, in a good read by Matt McGloin to get it in the hands of the receiver.
And that would be a big loss. Apparently he has a problem with the helmet. But that would be a big loss if he can't continue. He's one of their best defensive players. First and 10. Jesse James, that tight end, lined up in the backfield again. As usual, released his out into the pass pattern. They throw another tight end, Matt Lehman, who has a first down and more. Out of bounds at the 47. 12-yard game.
Well, they're not going to run the ball as the lead blocker, so he's going to set up, then delay. And you watch Matt McGloin, they're going to work the opposite side of the field again on the crossing route. Bill O'Brien lives off those.
Back to the run with Zwinak. Cross midfield to the Nebraska 47, and a good response by this Penn State offense. They really needed to move the ball. Momentum on the side of Nebraska. Up quickly to the line, the Lions. Zwinak drives through Cameron Meredith and appears to have another first down. Meredith and Sean Fisher combined on the stop. They're going to move the ball back about a half yard shy of the first down yardage.
Operating at their NASCAR pace to control the substitution of the Nebraska defense. You go NASCAR or hurry up offense, can't substitute.
McGloin keeps, and he has the first down. More than midway through the third quarter now. Ciante Evans returns to the field for the Cornhusker defense. Again, they're scrambling to line up on defense as the ball is snapped. And Zwinak fights for every inch. Pulled down by P.J. Smith.
You have to get that call in, just as important as it is on the offense to get it in defensively.
Zwinak breaks tackles. And Ciante Evans finally able to pull him down inside the 20-yard line. He is a powerful runner at 232 pounds, as P.J. Smith found out.
Yeah, it's nothing to do with the scheme, because P.J. Smith's in position to make the play in the hole. But Zwinak shows you what he's capable of with that power.
20-yard run. He didn't have anything longer than 18 this year prior to today, but he had a 50-yard touchdown for the game's first score. He was chopped down by Alonzo Whaley and Ciante Evans, and Zwinak comes off. Looked to be in some discomfort, and there's another Nebraska defender who's slow to get up.
Zwinak was grabbing his hamstring. It could be a cramp. It's warm enough to get cramps today.
Thad Randall, the defensive tackle, is the Cornhusker, who's down on a knee. Yeah, you don't expect to come to Lincoln and November and have it be 77 degrees. Beautiful day. And the wind has died down a bit. It's still blowing at 21 miles per hour. It was well over 30 miles per hour earlier. Randall's back on his feet, walking off. Swinak now up to 100 and 19 yards rushing. His career high is 134 1 week ago at Purdue. The Nittany Lions won for the third time in as many road games in the Big Ten this year. Had a favorable road schedule. Those wins at Illinois, Iowa, and Purdue. With a win today, Bill O'Brien would tie the Big Ten record by winning his first four conference road games as a head coach. Blitz, Sean Fisher didn't get to McGloin, who throws it away. The general direction of Brandon Mosby-Felder.
There's a growth right there of Matt McGloin of not panicking in front of the blitz, seeing nobody open, thrown away. Now you're third nine. Allen Robinson's been a little bit quiet, and also they've liked Jesse James down in this red zone area.
Well, they are in field goal range. And Ficken has kicked a 38-yarder today, his longest of the season. Third down and nine. Four-man rush. Down the middle and incomplete. Thrown into double coverage for Kyle Carter. Will Compton, the linebacker, dropped into coverage and broke it up.
Sean, we always talk about taking number three down the middle of the field. Carter is number three. You see Will Compton on the snap of the ball, go right to him, does not look back for the ball until the hands go up. Well executed by Will Compton and trusting his training and technique and doing his responsibility of care number three down the middle of the field.
Very smart player. Will wants to be a college coach. Carter grabbing his right hand or wrist. 35-yard try now for Sam Ficken for the lead. And it is good. Two for two today. He's made five in a row and seven of his last eight. Penn State, excellent response and leads by three. ESPN College football is available anytime, anywhere on your computer or mobile device via WatchESPN.com and the WatchESPN app. A short change, Sam Ficken after his most recent field goal. That was his third of the day. He's three for three, connecting from 27, 38, his longest of the season, and 35. Meanwhile, Kyle Carter going to the locker room. He's been grabbing at his right wrist, probably heading for x-rays. So now Ficken kicks off. He's made six straight field goals and eight out of nine, and a touchback with that strong wind behind him. Here's Robert Flores.
All right, Sean, here's what's happening on SportsCenter right now, brought to you by HP. In the Pac-12, Kevin Hogan to Zach Ertz. And number 14 Stanford leading number 11 Oregon 27-23 in the fourth quarter. Texas A&M still leading 20-17 over number 1 Alabama. Johnny Manziel has had his moments, but the Crimson Tide are down just three.
A lot of exciting games around the country today. Here's another one. Penn State has not trailed today. Nebraska scored 14 unanswered points to tie it up, but the Ficken field goal has put the Lions up by three. Abdullah around left end. And run out of bounds by the middle linebacker, Glenn Carson. James Terry, the injured player, senior defensive lineman from Newcastle, Delaware.
I don't think we've seen this many toss sweeps since John McKay at USC. Running it with student body right, student body left, and Penn State has a tough time containing it all day as Nebraska stays on schedule, getting their average on first downs, working in second and short situations, which they do quite a bit.
That make you think it's cramp?
Anytime you do that kind of motion where they're stretching it out, yes, and best injury you can have in that type of situation, if you're going to have one, have a cramp. They bounce back from that quickly.
We talked about Bill O'Brien and the job he's done. He's been widely praised for what he's done, both with the football part of the program and with everything else with which he's had to deal since he's been the head coach, starting in early January. If they win today, he and Earl Bruce will be the only first-year coaches in the history of the Big Ten since 1950 to win their first four conference road games. These are the men who have won their first three on the road, including Urban Meyer this year. Of course, he'll have the chance for a road win next Saturday at Wisconsin. And that's a big one as they try to remain in first place, the Buckeyes, and undefeated.
Yeah, they've done a good job this year. And going into the season, obviously knowing they couldn't play for the Big Ten championship or the, in this case, they'd be talking about the national championship being undefeated. So they've made a commitment to just do the best they can. They certainly focus toward that Michigan game as their bowl game, and they want to send their seniors out in a special way. And what better way to send them out than undefeated?
Terry up on his feet and limping off.
I'd like to think Urban Meyer learned a lot in the television booth last year.
From Dave Pasch.
We
certainly did.
Then we drove him out.
back
to coaching.
Very quickly. 1 year in the booth with you and Dave Pasch. There's Urban Meyer and the Buckeyes cheering for Nebraska today. Cornhusker win clinches at least a share of the leaders division title for Ohio State. Meanwhile, Nebraska, should it lose, would fall out of the first place tie with Michigan in the Legends division. Amir Abdullah. The yard, and that's about it. Jordan Hill made the tackle.
Sean, here's the most active defensive tackle that we've seen on film this year. Watch Jordan Hill get on the hip of Josh Jackson, number 72. Actually swims the guard and is able to get down to the line of scrimmage, showing no ill effects from the left knee injury that he sustained last week.
On third and one, the powerful Amani Cross is the tailback now. And he has a first down. The pulling right guard, Spencer Long. Michael Motti made the tackle for Penn State. And the conference title is first and foremost on the minds of these Nebraska players and coaches in their second year in the Big Ten. Bo Pelini's done a good job here. Won at least nine games in each of his first 4 years, but they haven't won a conference title, and around here, that's what they're accustomed to. Man wide open, Ben Cotton, the tight end. Upended by Adrian Amos at the 45 of Penn State. Another Nebraska first down, a gain of 18. First catch of the day for Cotton.
Yeah, habits. The habit of the toss sweep. But this time they fake the toss, and you'll see Cotton sneak behind the linebackers. You fake the toss, you get the linebackers running. You see all three of those linebackers running, including Motti, to hit the open cross on a crossing route.
Excellent call. Cotton's the son of their offensive line coach, Barney Cotton. Two brothers on this team. Taylor Martinez saw a seam. First down to the 34-yard line. The tackle made by Gerald Hodges, an 11-yard gain for Taylor Martinez.
We talked to Tim Beck, the offensive coordinator, and I asked him about, does Taylor make those decisions to run? Do you encourage him to run? He said, you know, I try to, but eventually I got to start trusting what Taylor sees. He usually makes good decisions, excellent decision to pull it down there and get yards with the feet.
And Tim Beck said he has the green light to run. Why wouldn't you let him run the way he runs? Abdullah. Ahead for two, Sean Stanley made the tackle. Amazing how quiet this crowd gets when Nebraska's on offense.
It's smart, aren't they?
They're so educated in every way. Such a classy crowd. Many opponents have talked about how classy the crowd is here, how appreciative they are of good play, how respectful they are of the opponents. Martinez kept it. Lost the football. He's ruled down by contact. About a yard short of the first down. Glenn Carson with the stop for Penn State. We're down to 3 minutes to go in the third quarter. Nebraska in field goal range now, but hoping to take the lead with a touchdown.
Well, that time you have a defensive lineman jump around a block, which opens the hole for Taylor Martinez. And you can see when the elbow hit the ground, the ball popped out. Thus, he's down.
212 rushing yards for Nebraska. They've been over 200 in 9 of their 10 games this year. Only Michigan held them under 200. Cross to the 20-yard line, and another methodical drive for Nebraska. First down.
Do you think they found a replacement for Burkhead on short yardage?
Yes.
And it's with the power O play, the lead with the fullback and the backside guard pulling around, get 2-on-1, and the big cross just follows them up, grinds out the first down.
He's at 5 carries today, 2 resulted in touchdowns, 2 others got first downs. Amir Abdullah swung down by the jersey by Gerald Hodges, the senior from Paulsboro, New Jersey, one of the best linebackers in the country, one of the 12 semifinalists, along with his teammate Michael Motti. The Butkus Award is the best linebacker in the country. Penn State's the only team that has 2 semifinalists for Butkus.
Well, Sean, we saw a lot of football this year, and I'll tell you, as a conference, I don't think there's a group of linebackers, the Big Ten, there's nobody better as a conference. We've been talking, even you can put Compton in that group, he's outstanding.
Yeah, you love Max Bulla, we saw last week at Michigan State, he's terrific. Here's Abdullah, first down, the 10-yard line. Gerald Hodges, another tackle. Reason to fear Amir. He's becoming the 100-yard rusher week after week again today, as he's up to 108. So that's 4 straight games with 100. And Nebraska's now had at least 1 100-yard rusher in each of their last 9 games. The longest streak of that type since 1999 and 2000, when they had a 100-yard rusher in 20 straight games. Abdullah. We're ready for him that time. Yanked down after a very short game by Glenn Carson. Stephon Morrison on the play for the Lions defense. Can they stiffen inside the 10-yard line again?
I love the adjustment by Ted Roof. They lined up in the I formation. He's not going to sit back there too deep. He brought Fagnano, number 27, the safety, up to the line of scrimmage to defend against the toss to the field. Excellent call and great adjustment by Coach Roof.
Heading into this gusty wind, 10 running plays on this drive, 1 pass.
It's about time for Taylor Martinez to keep it and go. Let's get that feeling.
He gave it to Abdullah, and he gets buried by Amos, but he wasn't down. Amos threw dirt on him, but he didn't bury him, apparently. Good restraint by the officials not to blow the whistle, and Abdullah wound up at the 3-yard line. What a play.
You see right there, he comes in his head.
I think he's down.
Yeah, his arm is down and his elbow's down, so they should bring that back. And I want to tell you something, what Amos did right there. Nebraska does a lot of crackback blocking. They crack on the safety. That means the receiver comes in and blocks the inside defender, and the corner's supposed to replace the safety, and that's exactly what they did. Take a look. Watch Bell come in here and crack on the safety. When he cracks down inside, you see the corner come up and replace where the safety's supposed to be. And again, that's a player understanding concepts on what to do. Love that. Well coached, well executed.
His elbow was down. Back outside the 11-yard line. It is being reviewed. It's been a relatively quiet day in the replay booth for Tom Herbert and Tom Fielder. ...16 seconds to go in the third quarter. Malcolm Willis, the injured player, he's had a very good day. We were saying earlier, Chris, during one of the commercial breaks, he's one of those guys, the more you watch Penn State play this season, the more appreciation you have for him.
Yeah, and I think the whole secondary is a whole, Sean, from the beginning of the year till now, all of them, including Malcolm Willis, have improved.
Good player, tough, hard-nosed, smart.
Down at the 13-yard line. It'll be first and goal from there. Please reset the game clock to 20 seconds. Ball will be placed on the left hash. The clock will start on my signal.
Good job in the replay booth. Well explained by John O'Neill. Instead of third and goal at the 3, it's third and goal at the 13. And they won't run another play in this quarter. They'll head to the other end of the field and go with the wind. They did a very good job, Chris, after their struggles going into the wind in the second quarter. Three punts in the quarter and 62 yards of offense going into the wind in the third quarter. A much different story.
Yeah, absolutely, and they did it on the ground. And the good thing about that, to take confidence, is Penn State knew you were going to run the ball, and they didn't do a lot to stop you.
Nebraska had 142 yards of offense in the third quarter. Outscored Penn State 14-3, but that three off the foot of Sam Ficken, the difference in the game. As we head to the fourth, 23-20, Lions. Nightfall descending upon the capital of Nebraska here in Lincoln. A good one. Nebraska dominated the third quarter. Three possessions, two touchdowns, and now this drive continues into the fourth quarter. Down by three, third and goal from the 12. Martinez, design run. Taylor Martinez lost the football, and it's recovered by Penn State at the goal line. Michael Motti knocked it out. Jacob Fagnano recovered. It'll come out to the 20-yard line.
Taylor's had a problem with this all year. Putting the ball on the ground, especially down in the red zone, you have to be able to cover it. It's a design quarterback draw. Watch number 42, the leader of the Nittany Lion defense, coming in with that left arm and stripping and ripping that ball out of there. And making a play when a play needs to be made. Why not let it be Michael Motti, the guy that's kept this thing together along with Bill O'Brien?
Third forced fumble of the season. He's had a team-high three interceptions. He's their leading tackler. Huge play by Michael Motti. Clearly it was a fumble. The Penn State had a fumble at the Nebraska 5 early in the game. And now Nebraska fumbles it away. The 11th fumble by Taylor Martinez, and he's lost six of them. And now the ball punched out away from Zornich by Alonzo Whaley, but fortunately for Penn State, it went out of bounds across the 26-yard line.
This is what you see in basketball a lot. Let's see if he secures the tackle with his left hand. That's a smart play right there. Securing with your left and coming around with a punch from behind. Caught a break.
Move the ball back to the 23-yard line. Zornich remains the running back. Opening minute of the fourth quarter. Matt McGloin running out of time. Throws in the general direction of the tight end Matt Lehman. Big third and seven upcoming. Here's Quint Kesnick.
Penn State showing some wear and tear on the sideline. Sean, safety Malcolm Willis, ice on his left knee. He looks like he's done for the day. Tight end Kyle Carter, who fought through the knee injury to play today, he is done with a right wrist injury.
Tears in his eyes. Missed last week's game with an ankle injury. They win at Purdue. That's a big loss. He's a terrific player. The only freshman tight end of the country on a watch list for the John Mackey Award is the best tight end. There are 26 players on that list. The Nebraska blitz. They got there. McGloin shoveled it ahead, incomplete. Intended for Alex Kenny. Ciante Evans, one of the blitzers nearest McGloin. Joe Gans, the former quarterback here in Nebraska, is a graduate assistant coach. The mentor to Taylor Martinez, giving him some advice as he gets ready to come back on the field. Boy, an injury starting to pile up on both sides. It's the second time today that's taken Ciante Evans a while to get up.
Good call right there.
by Papuchos, the defensive coordinator. Asiante's up and probably got the wind knocked out of him. And McGloin, one of the rare mistakes that he did, he stepped up into the pocket and he saw the receiver coming across late. If he would have saw him a little bit earlier, he had him wide open, because on the crossing route, which you do against blitz coverages, Josh Mitchell got picked off. McGloin just missed him, but it's, you know, that's tough duty when you got a lot of red shirts coming at you full speed.
Tough situation here for Alex Butterworth. That breeze still gusting around 30 miles an hour. They've been one of the worst punting teams in the country. That's a good effort under the circumstances. And he even got it to roll into the wind. Near the wind howling. He should clap for himself. That is an excellent job. 48-yard punt, one of his longest of the season. First and 10, Nebraska down by 3. 14 minutes to go here at Gula. Pollard by Gerald Hodges. No gain on the play.
Sean, you know, one thing we haven't seen is Nebraska take any attempts down the field. Now they have the wind with them, so it might be the time to take a couple shots deep. Taylor Martinez very accurate with the deep ball.
He averages 216 yards per game passing. He's thrown for only 105 today. Throwing lane was interrupted, so he pulled it down. He got about 5. Another tackle for Gerald Hodges. Daquan Jones also into the stop. Third down and 5, Nebraska. 7 out of 13 on third down today. Three wide receivers. And then the talented pass-catching tight end, Kyler Reed, on the field.
Ted Ruflex to bring pressure.
Martinez down the middle for Kyler Reed. Stays on his feet. He can fly. And down at the 10-yard line, run down by Gerald Hodges. 56-yard play.
Just talked about it. Take your shots down the field with the wind. Kyler Reed is over here on your field, in the field, and right here comes the pressure. Just patient for Kyler Reed, who beats Gerald Hodges one-on-one. That's a mismatch or a matchup that you want. Well executed, and again, with the wind, take your shot down the field. They picked up the pressure. Easy pitch and catch. Martinez to Reed.
Longest reception of the year for the senior. He had a huge fourth down catch in their rally in the fourth quarter last week at Michigan State. Martinez got back to the line of scrimmage. Michael Maudie ran him out. And here is that part of the field where the Penn State defense has had several wins. Forced 2 field goals on first and goal situations in the first half, and then came up with the forced fumble by Maudie when Martinez fumbled into the end zone. The last possession for Nebraska. Martinez trying to atone for it with 12 minutes to go in a 3-point game.
I'm going to look for Gerald Hodges to come off the edge right here. Number 6 is walking up. He's sneaking up. And they might back out.
Martinez to Abdullah. Inside the 5. Taken down by Deion Barnes. Jake Pugnano. That guy, I was going to say, he's going to be a star. He might be a star already.
Boy, both he and Stanley have been outstanding today. All right, 3rd and 4. So they like Big Ben Cotton. You got Kenny Bell working the trip side. And last week they hit Abdullah in the flat for a touchdown. A lot of different options. All else fails. Number 3 doesn't panic. He tucks it and scores. They're the options that Penn State has to defend.
Martinez throws, touchdown! Jamal Turner gives Nebraska its first lead of the game.
He's working one-on-one with Obing Ajapong. gives him a little bit too much room, backs off the cliff, goes into the end zone, allows Turner to work underneath on the inside. The one part of the field you want to take away, he did not. And Turner delivers with a touchdown in the fourth quarter, just like he did last week.
He had the game-winning touchdown with 6 seconds to go. It was his first career touchdown. He's a sophomore. Now he has a second career touchdown again in the fourth quarter to give them the lead. Sean Stanley slow to get up. We're seeing one player after another go down for Penn State. Well, talked about all the double-digit comebacks. You know, Martinez is part of the reason they get behind. He turns the ball over. And he's also a reason why they come back. He's one of those guys who can kind of keep both teams in the game.
See, well, last week he threw the pick down on the goal line to Denard from Michigan State. Turned it over here, but once again brought his team down the field. That tells me he's a mentally tough kid that feels like he's never out of it, so the team's never out of it.
Brett Maher trying to make it a four-point game, and he does. 71 yards and six plays. They took 3-10 to do it. The key third down pass to Reed set up the touchdown from 5 yards for Jamal Turner. These two schools, Penn State and Nebraska, the only two in the Big Ten, have a major for those who want to be golf professionals, teaching pros. Students learn the golf business, game instruction, golf course management, people skills. You know, our assistant pro at Boston Golf Club, Tom Hunt, is a product of the terrific program at Penn State. And they should be proud of him. He does a great job.
You ever think about attending? Did you ever think about attending?
No.
Except for the people skills, baby.
That was also not your most prettiest comment of the day. After the touchback.
Okay, Flaky.
Here's Robert Flores.
All right, guys, AT&T All-America Player of the Week nominee. It is Texas A&M quarterback Johnny Manziel. Now, there are still a lot of things that need to be determined in Tuscaloosa, but right now he has the Aggies on top, 23-17, and they're driving at the Alabama 25. Text vote to 34763.
Well, Johnny is a Heisman candidate, perhaps. Quick pass to Allen Robinson. He is yanked down from behind by P.J. Smith. After a short game, he'll mark it at the 27 for a pickup of two.
Let me tell you what's coming now. They set that up. P.J. Smith was very aggressive. Look for that same look, but having a receiver running deep. Something to keep your eye on as we move forward in this quarter.
And then the Lions trailing for the first time today. Heading into this gusty wind. Zach Swinnick runs people over and goes to the 45-yard line. 17 yards, give him 135. He has a career high for the second week in a row.
I'm having a flashback to Syracuse and the Miami Dolphins at number 39, Larry Zonka. That was a Zonka-like run.
Next, come back with torn ACL in his first year in the program. McGloin ran out of time and threw it away. Allen Robinson indicated to the officials he was being held. Nebraska's defense is very physical with receivers. They got called for three pass interference penalties last week in their win at Michigan State. Second and 10 from the 45.
Watch that fake screen and sending somebody deep. I got a feeling it's coming sometime this quarter.
Matt McGloin. Pump fake, deep ball. Tackled by Andrew Green inside the 20. And an accurate throw. It fluttered just a bit into the wind, or it might have been a touchdown.
And Sean, you talked about the aggressive defense of Nebraska. When you're aggressive like they are, Andrew Green, you're susceptible to the double move. Exactly what Allen did.
You gotta love Matt McGloin. Such a terrific competitor. To the 38-yard completion, Michael Zordich. To the 15, they'll give him just inside the 15, driven back by Baker Steinkuhler. McGloin's thrown for 231, extending his school record. That's his eighth straight game of 200 yards or more passing. The only quarterback ever at Penn State to do that. Swinnak back in. He got a yard. And big play calls here now for Bill O'Brien with under 10 minutes to go.
Third down situation and clutch situations down here in the red zone. They normally like number 87, Kyle Carter, but he has the wrist injury. Could they go to Jesse James, number 18, lined up in the slot?
On third and six, the bunch to the left. McGloin looked to the left. Started a run, nobody on the right side of the field, and they rip him down by a face mask. A huge break for McGloin and the Nittany Lions as Eric Martin commits the penalty.
Personal foul, face mask. Defense, number 46. Half the distance from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
This is the first time that Matt lost a little patience right here. Eric Martin's making a play. Now he has the face mask. You got to let it go. But now watch this. Watch Jesse James, number 18, sitting right down at the sticks. And Matt just came off him just a little bit. And he had plenty of time. There was no pressure. But that the first time tonight that he lost his patience, just a tad.
Would have been a two-yard loss and a tough fourth down decision for Bill O'Brien. Now first and goal after the sixth Nebraska penalty. Very costly. Zwinak running left. Powering down inside the three-yard line. Tackled by Cameron Meredith. Eric Martin, their best pass rusher among the defensive linemen out of the game. Leading sack man on the year. Second and goal, under 8 minutes to go. Penn State trying to take the lead back. Empty backfield. McGloin can run in this part of the field. Swings it out quickly to the tight end. The ball's out. Lehman lost it. Recovered in the end zone by Nebraska's Damian Stafford. Lehman was very close to the goal line. They'll certainly take a look at it. Martin overcome with emotion, thinking the defense has rescued him from his error on the penalty. The ruling on the field is a fumble. Did Lehman break the plane in the end zone with the ball? Looked like he did. Well, in his hands, and all he has to do is to get it to the front of that goal line. I think that's a touchdown, Chris. What do you think?
I think you're absolutely right. If we can freeze it right where the ball is, we'll take a look at it, and right
there.
Right there. That's over the line.
David Santos knocked it out with his knee. But it certainly appeared the ball broke the plane of the end zone. Yeah, no doubt.
That's 6 points. Nittany Lions.
Wow.
That's a tough call for the officials to make. That's a bang, bang play. The benefit of replay, you should get the right call.
Bill O'Brien telling the official he was over the line. Certainly looks like it.
Looked like he had possession and control of the ball when it crossed. Then it was knocked out right when it crossed. But you made a great point, Sean. A lot of people don't understand. It just has to pass the front part of the goal line. The whole ball doesn't have to be over the white line.
We've already had costly fumbles near the goal line by both sides. Zach Zwinak early in the game. Around the 5-yard line, Taylor Martinez fumbled in the end zone with his team going in.
The ruling on the field of touchback stands.
Wow.
First and 10.
Well, they said stands. They didn't say it's confirmed, so apparently they thought there wasn't enough visual evidence. The only thing I can guess, Chris, is that they thought the ball was coming out of his hands before it broke the plane, where they didn't have sufficient evidence to think from that angle that it broke the plane.
Yeah, and to me, I mean, that's a difficult call to make. It looked like he had possession of the ball, and the ball did cross the line with possession.
Amir Abdullah runs for 7 yards. We're told that the replay booth deemed that the ball was coming out before it crossed the line.
Okay, and that's the way they see it?
I mean, I don't agree with it. I think he has it in his hands, and he's extending the whole ball forward.
Absolutely.
It didn't come out until it hit Santos's knee.
I mean, that, they see it one way. We see it another way. It's a close call. To me, that's 6 points. Nittany Lions taken off the board. But you got to rally if you're defense. You can't worry about that now. You need to get this ball back and create position for your offense. You can't worry about calls. Go play your deal.
Abdullah stopped short of the first down. Well, let's go back and look at it. Is the ball coming out? Because that's what the replay people thought. No. It doesn't come out till there was contact. And the contact, as we saw from the side angle, right on the goal line, was when the ball was above the goal line.
You can't see it from that angle when the ball actually crossed. But from the sideline view, it looked to us that the ball did cross the goal line. Now here's the sideline view. Yeah. He's reaching, Lehman's reaching for the ball right
it's
there.
It's still in his hands. That's when it gets knocked away. And the ball was over the end line.
Sean, now this is a third and one. You bring Imani Cross in, you know they've run the power play every time he's been in the ballgame. Now you got to start guessing a little bit if you're Ted Roof. So you have a defense where you run a blitz right into that power play to stop it. And that's the fullback and the backside guard pulling. They're 3-for-3 on it right now.
Big play here. Penn State trying to get the ball right back. Cross is back in the game. Well, he's not going to get there. Where the official running in from the far sideline. He did not get the 30-yard line.
Anytime you can stop the puller from turning his shoulders upfield, you will stop the power play. That's exactly what the Nittany Lion defense accomplished in stopping that third and short yard play that was so successful for Nebraska earlier in the half.
Well, again, a terrific response by Penn State. Maher punting with the strong wind behind him. And he bombed it. Wow, what a kick. And perfectly placed. They're going to spot it at the 2. 69-yard punt by Maher, his longest of the season. Well, just moments after it looked like Penn State had scored a go-ahead touchdown. They'll have to march almost the full length of the field if they're going to take the lead on this possession. 98 yards away and heading into a gusty breeze. And dealing with tremendous noise, the quick hitter by the fullback Zordich gets them from the 2 to the 4. David Santos and Will Compton made the tackle. Boy, they need first downs because if they have to punt from here, Chris, the ball isn't going to go very far, you would think, into this wind.
They had a 48-yarder last time, but that was a little bit of a lucky bounce.
McGloin's going to throw out of his own end zone. Running out of time. Has to be careful of grounding. It's a safety if they rule that grounding. Line, no, they throw the flag. Cameron Meredith had the pressure.
Defensive grounding. 11 on the offense. Ball did not make it past the line of scrimmage, and he was not out of the pocket. The ball was played with safety.
Here's anchor number 9. He's the defensive end. He's the one that's setting the tackle box. Right here inside, Matt McGloin's going to let go of the ball when he is still inside of the tackle box. He takes 2 shuffle steps to the left. Still inside the box. Nobody in the area.
And Zordich was running away. McGloin very upset. He's lucky he didn't get flagged for the temper tantrum. I don't blame him for being upset. He'll be talking about that replay review for a long time. Totally changed the complexion of this game. Now Bill O'Brien and the Nittany Lions in a world of trouble. Here's a look at it one more time. The officials in the booth said the ball was coming out. You see right there, actually, if you run it back a frame especially, he had two hands on the ball. There, he's extending the ball. The officials say he lost the ball, but the ball's crossed the plane. He has two hands on it. It's over the end line, and then it comes out.
Yeah. It's a tough call. Yeah. Now, if you're Penn State, you have two calls. Okay, you don't agree with both calls. One wrong, the correct call in the end zone on the intentional grounding. You've got to get your guys together. We're still in this. It's a one-score game. We're going to get a defensive stop, and Matt McGloin's got to get with the offense and say, boys, we're going to take it down, and we're going to win it in the end.
They elected on the free kick to put the punter out there. Well, they might try Ficken, try to hit a hard ground ball. Instead, they'll punt it up into the wind. It's a short wobbler, as you might expect. And caught by Andy Janovich, a fullback out there on the kickoff return team. And good field position for Nebraska, trying to build on the lead. Tonight on ABC, Saturday Night Football, the undefeated Fighting Irish in Boston to take on the BC Eagles. Been an ugly year for BC, but a chance for a huge upset against a rival, number four Notre Dame. Saturday Night Football presented by Windows 8 tonight, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC. .502 to go, first and 10, Nebraska. Scored 9 unanswered points to take the lead. Amir Abdullah slides out to the 48, a gain of 5. Jordan Hill with the stop for Penn State.
Just a tough runner, and you look at the guy the size of Abdullah thinking, well, he's just a speedy little scat back. I'll tell you, he's more effective running inside than he is outside. Strong, powerfully built.
Needed 24 yards today, did Abdullah, to get to 1,000 yards rushing for his career. He's well past that. He's the 60th player in the history of Nebraska football with 1,000-plus career rush yards. Chance to add to his total, but he's stopped behind the line of scrimmage. Jordan Hill, another big play. Here's Robert Flores.
All right, Sean, we got a change in Tuscaloosa in the score. Johnny Manziel, 24 of 30, 253 yards and 2 touchdowns, and that one puts A&M on top, 29-17, 8 minutes and change to go in Tuscaloosa. Coming up tonight on ABC, Manti Te'o and number 4 Notre Dame, undefeated, taking on Boston College, hoping for a little bit easier time than last week against Pittsburgh.
Timeout called here by Penn State. 4:11 to go, 2 timeouts left. Well, there could be a major upheaval in the BCS standings if Texas A&M goes on to win. Alabama survived a big-time scare last week at LSU. Here are the latest BCS standings brought to you by Vizio. They'll change tomorrow. Kansas State at TCU tonight.
That's a tough place to go, and TCU's a good football team.
Offense, number 76. 5-yard penalty, still 3rd down.
Brett Qualley, the left tackle, staggering backwards. There's another look at the BCS standings, but obviously Kansas State, Oregon, Notre Dame would be overjoyed by an Alabama defeat if that score stands.
Man, how about Georgia sitting in there?
Mm-hmm.
Really tough loss. And coming back playing strong, especially on the defensive side of the ball.
3rd down and 14. Another big play. They show blitz. Lottie blitzes from the outside. Didn't get him. Martinez across the line. Tripped up by Mike Hull. The ball is out. They're going to spot it where? Officials pointing and conferring. They're going to give him the forward yardage. Apparently lost the ball after he hit the ground. 45, well short of the first down by about 8 yards, where they're going to mark it. And his knee is down. But who knows? Maybe there'll be a replay review. All right, should we let that go?
Remember that people skills thing?
They're not going to let it go in Happy Valley for a long time.
No, they're not.
They're very unhappy in Happy Valley right now.
You're watching ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by K Jewelers.
One. Two.
Three.
My credit card rewards are easy to remember.
With the Bank AmeriCard Cash Rewards credit card,
earn 1% cash back everywhere, every time.
2% back on groceries.
3% on gas.
Automatically. No annual fee, no hoops to jump through.
I earn more cash back on the things I buy most.
It's as easy as...
Three.
The Bank AmeriCard Cash Rewards credit card. Apply online or at a Bank of America near you.
Ladies, why is your man watching this snoozer of a game? Because I'm on his fantasy football team. So he gets for 10 points if we win or not. Boom. It's a guy thing. Like Dr. Pepper 10. With all 23 flavors of Dr. Pepper and just 10 manly calories, it's like a fantasy soda, but you can drink it.
Get in there, hot dog!
It's what guys want. Like scoring touchdowns with players that fake coaching. Woo! So close. So keep the reality TV and lady drinks. We're good.
Dr. Pepper 10. It's not for women.
They say opposites attract. But does that work for a car? Ask Scott Mikowski. He and his team set out to combine power and fuel efficiency. People said it wouldn't work out. People were wrong. Here's proof. An EcoBoost engine in the new Ford Escape. With up to a best-in-class 33 mpg highway and plenty of power to spare. It's the little engine that most definitely can. The all-new 2013 Ford Escape. It's what happens when you go further.
Bye, Daddy.
Bye. Bye, girls. Love you.
Daddy, we made you a video for your trip.
Yeah, watch it on the airplane. Yeah.
Okay.
Here you go.
Aw, thanks, girls.
Yeah. Hey. I also made you a video.
Aw, that's so sweet.
You probably shouldn't watch it on the plane.
Share videos instantly on the Samsung Galaxy S3, amber, brown, and black, exclusively on Verizon.
Tomorrow night on ESPN and ESPNU, Reese Davis, Kirk Herbstreit, Jesse Palmer, and David Pollock unveil the latest BCS poll. Could be major upheaval with Alabama on the ropes right now. BCS Countdown presented by Vizio tomorrow night at 8:30 on ESPN, continuing at 9 Eastern on ESPNU. Rhett Maher to punt. He hasn't had one block this year. Had a 69-yarder the last time they went out at the two and set up the safety. He's had an inconsistent year. They come after him. And he got it off. And it bombs into the end zone. 55-yard punt with the win. So much better field position this time for Matt McGloin. One timeout left for the Nittany Lions.
I think Bill O'Brien said, hey, Matt, let's do our best Tom Brady impersonation right now. Why don't you just be Matt McGloin, which has been solid all year.
.344 remaining, one timeout. The wind still howling into their faces. Four-man rush, well blocked, incomplete pass. Intended for Matt Lehman with Justin Blatchford in coverage.
You know, a lot of times in this situation, you hear people say, why do teams play prevent, especially when you need six? Well, I got news for you. Nebraska's getting aggressive on defense. They're getting up in their grill and challenging them. So an opportunity for a big play is there.
Give them credit. They had difficulty in the first half. Gave up 20 points in the first half. Burned timeouts when they couldn't get the right folks on the field or lined up properly. Got rid of those problems in this half. McGloin, a sinker, low and away. Intended for Brandon Mosby Felder with Josh Mitchell in coverage. Third and 10.
Well, again, reading routes. That time Josh Mitchell ran a curl just like Mosby Felder ran a curl and almost beat him to the football. Might be time for double moves, Sean. They're playing that aggressive.
You want to take a shot with a double move. Will John Papuchis and Bo Pelini bring a blitz on third down and 10? Play clock at 2:01. They didn't get it off. They call the timeout instead.
Charge timeout, Penn State. The third and final timeout. 30 seconds.
They're out of timeouts. Sideline saw the play clock was about to expire. They decided it was worth it to burn the last timeout rather than have to pick up a critical third and 15. There's our Civic Life game summary. Nebraska's had control of the second half. Matt McGloin, 233. Martinez, 287 total. He's thrown for 171. And if they hold on, it'll be their fourth win in the Big Ten this year for Nebraska when they were down by double digits in the second half.
Well, that says something about leadership of the players and coaches. And asked Bo about that, and he just said, these guys just keep believing they're going to win. It doesn't matter where they are. They just keep believing they're going to win.
They have a lot of playmakers. Now Bill O'Brien needs somebody to make a play. And, yeah, it looked like he didn't like the look of this play call against the defense. They didn't have a timeout to change it. McGloin, can he get to the 30? No, got belted down by Cameron Meredith with help from P.J. Smith. And what will Bill O'Brien do? No timeouts left. He's going to go for it.
Well, you have
this
to.
This is the game right here. Fourth down and 6.
You see, there's big number 18, Jesse James, who's a size matchup problem for Nebraska against the linebacker or safety. Remember the last series, he had Jesse James open on a little in route.
They've been one of the best fourth down teams in the country. This is as big as any they've had this year. Four-man rush. McGloin started to step right. Throw is incomplete. Broken up by Blatchford. Intended for Alex Kenny. Nebraska takes over on downs.
Sean, here's what we're talking about, zone matchups. See, these guys are going to play man-to-man, but they're going to wait for the Penn State players to come to their area. See, they let them go, and each guy waits for them to come to their area, then they jump them on the zone matchup. You cannot play it any better. Whatever lack of communication there was in the first half, certainly not there in the second half for Bo Pelini and his Cornhusker defense.
Penn State cannot stop the clock. 2:39 to go. Amir Abdullah for the line of scrimmage, and that's it. And the clock will run under 2.5 minutes to go. When life's plans don't always have a happy ending, you better have your friends to fall back on, even if they make it worse. It's being called the best comedy on TV, Comedy Gold, and a blast to watch. They'll miss an all-new episode of Happy Endings Tuesday, 9, 8 Central on ABC. That'd be a very unhappy ending and a controversial ending for Penn State if it stays this way.
True freshman in there. You tell him to hold on to the football with two hands.
Monty Cross comes up about 2.5 yards short of the first down. They are in field goal range. And a field goal would be huge. It would make it a two-score game and then virtually an insurmountable lead. And Brett Maher getting ready in case he's called upon. And they pick up a first down here. They'll get into the take-a-knee mode and the game will be over. Cross didn't get there, and now Bo Pelini has a decision to make. The field goal ices it, but picking up the first down ices it. If you kick the field goal, you run the risk of a block. I think he's going to let the clock run all the way down, use the timeout, and think about what he wants to do. He'll take the clock down to about 27 seconds.
A similar situation in today's Michigan-Northwestern game, where Michigan got the ball back with 18 seconds, hit a Hail Mary, then kicked a game-tying field goal to get it into overtime, then winning it in overtime against Northwestern. Penn State would get the ball back here if he goes for it and they don't get it.
Timeout.
Their first, 30 seconds.
What would you do? Would you go for the fourth down? I think even if you go for the fourth down, Chris, that's the safer play, because, you know, if you get it, it's game over. Even if you don't get it, you're giving them the ball inside the 20. Penn State would have to go 80 plus yards in about 25 seconds or less with no timeouts and into this stiff wind.
Yeah, because of the wind, I would go for it right here to ice the game and trusting my defense to win the ball game. I think if the wind was going the other way, just to play it safe, I'd trust my execution of my field goal team and I would kick the field goal and make it a two-score game. But since the wind is in their face, Penn State, if they get the ball back, go for it.
As we could tell as we were speaking, as the wind was blowing papers all across our booth. Sorry, I was a little distracted. Usually I'm hanging on every word you speak. Well, they're going to send the field goal team out here.
I don't have a problem with this call either.
Well, you have a very good kicker ordinarily. He hasn't had his best year, but he was the Big Ten place kicker of the year last year. This would ice it, but a first down would ice it too. And the kick is good. As we said, kick the field goal. 33-yarder. Puts this one in the win column. And it'll be a very controversial loss that they'll be talking about for a long time. You have replay to correct mistakes. And to us, replay did not correct this mistake. It was ruled a fumble on the field and a touchback. Matt Lehman extended the ball. Looked like he had two hands on the ball across the plane. Then it was jarred loose. The replay officials said they thought the ball was coming out before the contact. It looked to us like he still had two hands on the ball, was extending it to the line, and got it to the line before it hit the leg of Santos and came out.
Well, you know, I can understand on the field why they called that a fumble.
Yeah,
that was a bang. You can't see that. And when you have the benefit of the replay and we actually stop the replay and show the ball across the plane, touchdown.
And in case there's any question among the viewers, that camera's right on the goal line.
Yes.
It wasn't like, well, maybe the angle was off, and it wasn't. And that's not what the replay officials offered as an explanation anyway. They know it was right on the end line. We've canvassed everybody in our booth, and we haven't heard anybody in the production truck either say they thought it was a fumble. But our opinion doesn't matter.
Nope. Don't forget, Nebraska benefited from a controversial call last week on a pass interference that many thought.
Yep. Second week in a row.
Including myself.
They're going to benefit one way or the other. This time from a replay review. Here's a key pass interference call against Darquez Dennard.
Wow.
And then it set up the winning touchdown in the final seconds. Matt McGloin. Ooh, hit Will Compton in the helmet. He was focused on Zach Zwinak and didn't see the ball coming.
We had a chance to speak with Will last year a little bit. We were just talking about some looking, getting a kick out of that. And it's easy to get a kick out of it if you're losing it. A dropped interception means nothing. But, you know, I like to talk to young linebackers and just offer him a few pointers on maybe watching film and how he can help himself.
In the flat, Zwinak. Wrestled down by Compton. His brother Cody is a wrestler on the Nebraska wrestling team, 165-pounder. And that might do it. Lions try to get off one more play, and the clock ticks to zero. And McGloin spun down. Apparently that play is going to count. There was no real definitive gesture by the officials. Nebraska retains control of its own destiny in the Legends division of the Big Ten. And with the Nebraska win, Ohio State has clinched at least a share of the Leaders division title. Here's Quint Kesnick.
Coach Pelini saying congratulations to Michael Mata. Coach, down 20-6 at halftime. What'd you emphasize at the break?
Like I said, going into it, about executing and fixing some of the things that we didn't do well, players, coaches alike, and I thought we came out, we got a little momentum going there in the second half, and we're able to finish off. A lot of respect for this Penn State football team and their kids, and I'm happy to get out here with the win.
Yeah, your fourth second half double-digit comeback win. What is that like for you?
Not good for the ticker, but hey, I'll take it. You know. Tough way to go. We can't keep living like this, but I'll take the win.
Congratulations, Coach. Sean.
An important win it is. They have an eye on the Big Ten championship game. Whichever team wins the Legends Division is going to play Wisconsin, which clinched a trip to the championship game by virtue of its win today. Even though Ohio State has a two-game lead, neither Ohio State nor Penn State is eligible to play in the Big Ten championship game due to NCAA sanctions. So Wisconsin will play the winner of the Legends Division, and Nebraska is still in control of its destiny with a home game against Minnesota and a game at Iowa left on the schedule. Nebraska outscored Penn State 26-3 in the second half. 32-23 the final. Be sure to tune in tonight for Notre Dame and Boston College. For Chris Spielman, Quint Kesnick, and our terrific crew, Sean McDonough saying so long from Lincoln, Nebraska.